Evening, everybody. It's sort of 6:30. There are at least three clocks in here plus, so we'll go ahead right now. Welcome to everybody. Got a fair bit of stuff to get through before we get to the main part of the meeting, as ever. And as it's a special meeting, it's a call-in meeting. I just need to redeclare my independence as chair, which of course you all know, so that's good. Fire evacuation procedure for tonight. There are no fire alarms scheduled for this evening. Therefore, if the fire alarm sounds, please evacuate the building immediately. The fire exits are located at the rear and side of this room. Go down the stairs and meet in the War Memorial Park. Just to remind you, the meeting is being webcast live on the internet. Check with officer for confirmation. And can I just remind you to turn your phones off or to silent, please? There may well be, since there are a rather large number of pink papers, there may be a need to pass the following motion, because these meetings are normally public. In order for us to do that and ask the public to leave, we have to pass this motion. Can we pass it now? All right, okay. So we can't pass it now, so I don't know why I bothered to tell you. We'll do that later. Yeah. If we are able to keep it open and without reference to some of those, then we will do. But if it gets to the point where we need to, then we will. That said, apologies for absence and substitutions. We've got an apology from Councillor Phillimore with Councillor Potter substituting. Welcome. We have some members of the public. Good evening. You're very, very welcome. I understand some of you are, or at least one of you wishes to address the committee. So I would like you to come and sit on the front row so I know how many of those are wishing to speak at the committee meeting. You will be allowed a couple of minutes. I'm afraid that's all that the members of the public get. But you will get a couple of minutes free to say whatever you need to say. And then the committee will be invited to ask you questions if they wish to. Is that okay?
Yes.
Thank you. Okay. We now need to appoint two vice chairmen of the scrutiny committee, one from the administration and one from the non-administration for this meeting, in fact. So can I take nominations for the vice chair of the normal meetings, the usual meetings, please? Councillor Taylor.
Thank you, Chair. I'd like to propose Councillor Hannah Golding, please.
Thank you. Is that seconded? Councillor Smith, second. Everybody okay with that? Good. Thank you. Now I need to appoint a vice chair for tonight. Who will be the vice chair on this and any other call-ins in this year. So may I have nominations from the non-administration, the opposition? Yes, Councillor Potter.
If I may, Chair, I know I'm substituting tonight, but can I nominate Councillor Ian Tilbury?
Thank you. Is that seconded? Thank you, Councillor Gavin James. Thank you. Is there any other nominations? All agreed? Ian, would you mind taking the long Green Mile walk up here? Declarations of interest. Are there any declarations of pecuniary or non-pecuniary interests? No? Okay, thank you. Not quite. Oh, that's the minutes, isn't it? Do we have any urgent matters to consider before we move to the minutes of the meeting held on the 8th of March? No, good, thank you. Item 5, then, the minutes of the meeting held on the 8th of March, which have been previously circulated. Everybody okay with them? Any questions? No? Can I sign them? Thank you. I've got to sign it all. I'll have to go in at the end. Thank you very much. And now we're on to the main item for the agenda, which is the call-in for the Basingstoke Leisure Park. Once again, I need to remind us that we have, you know, a plethora of confidential papers. So, members, if you could just be aware, if you're referring to one, that to let us know, because we will have to go in closed sessions and pass the relevant resolution. What's going to happen is that the signatories will explain the reason for their call-in. They get 25 minutes for that. And then a member of the public gets his 2 minutes. Then the relevant cabinet member will have an opportunity to comment, and that's Councillor Robert Tait. The relevant director can provide background. That will be Laura Taylor and Mike Bovis. Members of the committee can then ask questions, and that's of the signatories or the cabinet member, if you wish. We will have a discussion. I will then sum up. The signatories will have an opportunity to indicate if they're satisfied, and we then invite the cabinet member to make any final comments. I hope that we can get through this tonight, but if we don't, at some point we'll have to adjourn the meeting with your agreement. But the good news is we've got another meeting next Tuesday already that we can duck shove around a little bit. So is there, have I missed anything, my massive legal team? Oh, I have, excuse me. Thank you. There are two outcomes that can come from tonight. The first is that the committee decides to take no further action, in which case the decision will take effect. Or the committee may decide that the committee may wish to see the decision referred back to the cabinet, in which case we will have to ensure that our concerns as a scrutiny committee are clearly set out, and then that will go back to the committee for them. It will go back to the cabinet member for him to deal with. Okay, is that all right?
I think I'll raise it now, if I may, with your permission. I mean, could I, just for the public record, and much as I enjoy Councillor Tait's company always, could I just clarify why he is here this evening dealing with this call-in and not Councillor Isett? I'm bemused. I understood Councillor Isett to be the portfolio holder and decision maker in regard to the Leisure Park project. And I'm bemused to see Councillor Tait here. I just wondered whether that could be clarified for me.
I have to say I'm probably not in the best position to clarify it for you, but I could ask Councillor Tait to.
Pretty straightforward. The cabinet decision was brought forward by myself, and therefore I'm responsible for the decision, and therefore in terms of scrutiny I'm responsible to be accountable for that in front of the scrutiny committee. Councillor Isett was not part of the discussion at cabinet, and he was not part of the decision at cabinet, and therefore has no position to be at this particular meeting.
Councillor Potter.
I mean, just as a matter of fact, I mean, Councillor Isett was a participant in the discussion that took place at cabinet, so I think that needs to be put on record. But again, just to be absolutely clear, is it now the case that Councillor Tait is the decision maker in respect of this particular project from here on in? Is that what is being said?
Councillor Tait.
Completely logically, I am the decision maker. Until some such time as somebody takes that decision away from me, I am the decision maker.
Councillor Potter. Well, can I invite the signatories to come to the table, please? And there's 25 minutes to go. I've no idea how to use it.
Good evening, thank you, Chair. Good evening, members. Thank you for giving me the opportunity to address the committee this evening. As you know, the signatory submitted this call-in request on the 20th of April. I want to stress at the outset, so there can be no mistake, I'm 100% behind the redevelopment of the leisure park, 100% behind the concept of first-class facilities needed and used by our residents. I just don't think we need a huge shopping centre to go with it. The call-in was submitted because ultimately we think the Cabinet's decision can be improved upon. We have a number of concerns about the direction that the Cabinet is going down, and we have a number of concerns over the process that has been followed. These are all summarised in our call-in request, and to quote from that request, as signatories, we would welcome the views of the committee in arriving at the course of action to deal with our concerns. In other words, we think this decision can be improved upon, and we will look into this committee to constructively assist in that process. The Council's legal officer reviewed the call-in request and agreed that in certain areas the call-in was justified and should be allowed. The two vital points to pull out from the monitoring officer response are that in paragraph 2 he concludes that the call-in is not frivolous, repetitive or improper, and in paragraph 14 and 15 he agrees with the signatory's claim that it has not been possible to show that all the relevant risks have been identified, considered and dealt with in accordance with the Council's policy. He then goes on to recommend that the use of the risk matrix contained within the risk management policy will clearly show this has occurred by putting all the identified risks into one place, with these being dealt with in turn. The Council's legal officer also refers in paragraphs 44 and 45 of his report of two other deficiencies in the identification and assessment of risk. He concludes in paragraph 48 that therefore he considers that the call-in is successful on the grounds that Borough Council's risk management policy was not followed as indicated above. The reason I mention this background now is because I want to emphasise to the committee that this is not just a couple of opposition councillors having a moan at a council decision. This is the council's own legal officer advising you as members of the scrutiny committee that the risk management policy has not been followed and recommending that the risk matrix is produced and him concluding that the call-in is successful on these grounds. It is now down to this committee to make 100% sure that the risk management policy is fully complied with. It was good to see then, as part of the agenda pack for this evening's meeting, that a project risk register has been produced and now identifies 24 risks. This is shown on page 339 of your papers. And so in theory, this one document attempts to resolve all of the issues that the signatories have raised in their call-in request and deals with the recommendations from the Council's legal officer. So this one sheet of paper is the vital document for the whole call-in. It is concerning, therefore, that I, as a signatory, and I'm assuming you as members of the committee, first saw this sheet less than a week ago. I believe it was issued electronically last Tuesday and in paper format last Thursday. I would also say that it is an extremely difficult document to read, certainly in printed format, which I think is unfortunate considering its importance to the call-in. More important than that, though, is that from my initial analysis, there are several risks that I mentioned within the body of the report that still haven't been listed on the risk register, properly assessed, and mitigation proposed accordingly.
Two examples of this would be the fact that the developer of a designer outlet centre will have a negative impact on the town centre trade. That is a fact and is borne out by analysis contained within the report. So I have to ask, why is this risk not listed on the register? Secondly, the report identifies that New River Retail won't commence building on work on the site until a specific percentage of the site is pre-let. This again is a risk to the project and should also be listed on the risk register with any appropriate mitigation measures. I'm sure that there are others, and I'm concerned that in short period of time that we've had to identify just these two risks, there must be many more. I'm also concerned that the risk register is being produced by the project team, and I think it would be too close to the issues, they are too close to the issues, to be able to necessarily objectively assess them properly. I think we should suggest in our call-in request that the register should perhaps be compiled by someone independent to the project, internal audit, for example. Bringing all of this together, I would like to put a proposal forward in order to move this on. I would like to propose that the Chair's agreement that the risk register, as identified on page 339, is reviewed by someone independent of the project, perhaps internal audit, and that internal audit take the risk register away, look at it in relation to the officer report and the earlier comments, and bring back a revamped risk register to this committee. I don't think that this is a major piece of work, maybe a few days, but it would be you as members and committee a chance to be reassured that the risks have been identified, assessed and recorded in that way the council's legal officer is recommending. I see to do otherwise would necessarily leave this council vulnerable to challenge at a little later down the line in the context of this particular call-in. And we would like to put that proposal to you now, Chair.
Okay. Well, that certainly would make this evening's meeting a little shorter. So you're proposing that the risk register goes to internal audit for them to principally run an audit on... Okay.
To be absolutely clear, Chair, certainly. We propose with the Chair's agreement that the risk register identified on page 339 is reviewed by someone independent of the project. Internal audit would be appropriate. They take it away. They look at it in regard to the officer report. They look at it in terms of the comments that have been passed, revamp the risk register, bring it back to this committee, which is the appropriate committee to be reviewing it in order to benefit the decision, to make the decision better, and that gives the committee the assurances they're looking for in terms of identified, assessed and recorded risk. It also satisfies the legal officer's comments in the report to bring this call in here in the first place.
Okay, thanks. I think I understand what you're asking. That seems like an eminently sensible idea. Okay, thank you. Just so you know, we have paused the time. I think it might be sensible to ask the cabinet member and officers what they think of that proposal. So would one of you please like to react to that? And because I've heard you've been having a conversation. And then we'll discuss it. The rest of the committee will discuss it. So I don't know who wants to.
Thank you. The comment I'd make is that there has been an informal discussion between the project team and internal audit. And internal audit asked or recommended going to the internal project team, program office, to review the risk management. And it's been done. So there has been contact with internal audit. And internal audit made a recommendation which has been followed, and that follow has left us where we are with the risk matrix as it is now.
So, just so I'm clear, internal audit have seen this risk matrix. So internal audit have not seen this risk matrix.
They haven't seen the version of it, but it has been discussed as to where the appropriate place for the management of that particular document should be.
Right, so I'm still confused. It seems to me you're saying that they haven't seen internal audit, haven't seen this, so they haven't said this is a good document. And no, hang on, they haven't actually seen it. Yes, that's correct, isn't it? They have suggested where you should put it. Yeah,
they have discussed with internal audit the process and where that should be allocated. They have not, you're quite right, seen this particular document. They have been discussing the process and where that process fits, and therefore it has been discussed with the right area that internal audit have asked them to go to.
So I'm not sure I understand what you're saying. This is a risk register. It's got some reds on it. You're saying internal audit have said, it's okay, push it back to the people that are managing the project. Yeah? Is that what you're saying? I'm getting yeses, noes. Yes.
Basically, I picked it up informally with the head of internal audit and explained the concerns that members had over the risk register. The advice I had from the head of internal audit was that we should pick it up with the council's own programme board, who are the ones that oversee all the various programmes, because it's a specialist area that looks at projects, and this is very much a project risk register. And that's, you know, the advice I took, that's the advice I followed. It's been gone through by the not connected with the project program board. They've looked at it, assessed it, and said, seems to be comprehensive.
Yep, certainly, ma'am.
Sorry, I just want to point out the bit in the relevant policy. So the risk assessment policy, risk management policy that we're referring to this evening says that each business unit identifies their own service risks, which are recorded within each business unit's service plan. So the recommendation from the policy is that it's dealt with by the business unit who's dealing with that type of work. However, that doesn't prevent audit reviewing it, but I just wanted members to be aware of what's in the actual policy.
Gentlemen, you were, yes?
The point is that the project team may well have conducted a process that's resulted in the document you see before you this evening. We're suggesting that an independent set of eyes go over that. The project team shouldn't necessarily be marking their own work in the context of this. And having a confidence that the assessment and the substance, not just the process, but the substance of it has been appropriately reviewed, is where we would like to go on this. I notice the clock is ticking down, rather than me simply making a contribution back.
Okay, do we accept that?
It's just, I think you have to understand the difference between the programme board, which operates within the council, which effectively takes an overview of all the different projects. It's not part of the project team for this particular project. So it is independent to the project, and therefore, I'm not quite sure I see the point. It is an independent review of the project's risks and the programme.
Who are they? Who are they? Name them. Is it your team, Kevin? Does anybody know who they are?
Yes.
Well, who are they?
Yes, they are team. They're a team within the performance and review section.
And their function?
Part of the function is to support the council's project management process. And I assume that's who Mike is referring to.
Is that sufficient, signatories?
It's process and not substance. What we're seeking here is a review of the substance of this, the concerns, the issues that have been raised in the risk register, such that this committee can have an independent, appropriate report brought back that the committee can review in the context of what's been presented in the paperwork. The process might be the process, might be the process, but it isn't the substance. And again, the point I would make is it's the team marking their own work. What we're suggesting is an independent review, and suggesting our internal audit team are quite capable of doing that for us would be the suggestion. That way we get a fresh set of eyes in a sense of a review of the risk register as presented, the issues raised that the call-in has accepted, come back here, and you have an opportunity then to see it with an independent view attached.
Thank you. Give me one minute. Okay, what I'm going to do now is open it up to the committee to have a discussion about this, and then we'll come to a decision. Happy for you guys to be part and parcel of that. Councillor James and then Councillor Miller, sorry.
Thank you, Chair. I think we run a risk of spending the evening talking about which men in grey suits in which darkened office look at the risk assessment. I think the fundamental issue is, are we satisfied that the one in front of us is robust and captures all the risks and deals with those risks appropriately? And I think certainly from the call-in point of view, it doesn't. So I think we need to concentrate on making sure we review the risks as they currently sit, invite the portfolio holder to consider any new risks we highlight, and where we think there is a risk highlighted but not properly mitigated, we don't think it's fully covered the full impact of that risk, we should give them that advice. Ultimately, the portfolio holder is responsible for the decision. If this goes completely wrong, it's his problem, no one else's. He's made the decision. He's made it very clear tonight he's responsible for the decision. Where he seeks advice over his risk register is probably a matter for him to decide. And if he gets that wrong again, that's his own responsibility. What's important tonight is we don't waste time talking about where it goes, because ultimately it goes to the portfolio holder to consider and then take advice from wherever he wants to seek it. What we must get to the point of is going through this risk register and identifying what risks aren't in there that should be and which risks are in there but haven't been properly mitigated.
Thank you, Councillor Miller.
Thank you, Chair. I have a bit. I bring a bit of a professional background to this because I'm a bit involved in program management. I'm not talking to you about that. Allow me to speak, Councillor Keating. What Mike Bovis has said tonight is exactly right, and that in industry, in anywhere else, is best practice when you develop a risk register. This is the start of a very large project, and you would expect a risk register in the in what appears on page 339. Fully expect that to be have some missing elements and some, at the moment, red items on it. Fully expect it. The risk register is a living document. As a program progresses, and what is this program? 3 years? 4 years? It's an iterative process. The risk register is constantly changing. The project team identify that. The program board, or I would say, I term it, and professionally, you term it a quality verification and validation of these documents, is done at regular intervals throughout the project. This is not the risk register. It is the start of a very long program, and the risk register will probably end up as a document, a quite a thick document at the end, because you cannot foresee what risks will appear. You might like to think you can, but this is the start of a very long process, and that's what it is. It's a necessary process, and it is contained and maintained by the project team. If in the council's organization you have a program board, they're not interested in the details of it. They will make an independent judgment of it. If you want to include the audit function within the council, fine. It's just that it's another layer, and it may be that between the officers, they can make their own judgment where it goes. But don't take this risk register as published as being the risk register. It certainly isn't, and it will never be until towards the end of the project. Risks come up, the mitigation of those risks are identified, and I won't even speculate what they could be. They could be many and various. I'd just like to point that out, that it's best practice. It's been identified now on 339. That's the start of a very long process, and it maintains and lowers the risk of the whole program.
Councillor Keating.
Thank you, Chair. First of all, can I say, as a member of the Audit Committee, this whole issue of, in any form, has not been to the Audit Committee. Neither has there been any report from the Programme Board to the Audit Committee. Neither have I seen any documentation which says the Programme Board looked at it. So there is no evidence that the Programme Board has contributed to this particular process. Secondly, can I say, each project will have a series of risks. They're not the same, because every project would be different. This particular project is a very large one, very extensive, and has identified, up to now, in all of the reports that we've seen, a number of high risks. They're red on the document, and a high risk is a very significant issue that needs to be mitigated before you go any further. The yellow ones, there are no greens, by the way. The yellow ones are, they're significant risks that should be mitigated before you go any further. Now, one of the risks that's not identified, as I understand it, that should have been identified on this particular register, is the experience of New River Retail in designing and organizing and managing or creating designer centers. As far as I'm aware, they have no experience of doing such a thing. The other thing that is confused within the document is the issue in relation to public consultation. Now, as I understand it, Chair, the public consultation is intended to take place after the deal has been done. After the deal has been done. In other words, you go to the public and say, by the way, we're thinking of, oh no, sorry, by the way, we have agreed a deal with to redesign the whole of the leisure park, and we've given it to one contractor, and we're now only going to consult you about the new build on that site. Now, public consultation, in my view, is seriously depleted if it's dependent upon a planning application after the deal is done. If you go to consultation after you've done the deal, you're misleading the public. Because once you've done the deal, you have legal constraints, you have legal obligations, and you have financial obligations. So, on the basis that no one else other than the project team, who have contributed to the contents of this risk register with all its red and yellow, they have said there are risks. They're identified. But there is no mitigation category in terms of what we're doing about them. That's the next stage. If you have a register of risks, you identify the risks, you try to quantify them, and then you decide and decide properly how to deal with them before the project goes forward, especially if they're in the red category, i.e. high risk. So on that, on the basis that no one else has looked at the risks other than the current project team, it's not irrational or unreasonable to say we do need more people to have a look at the risks and the risk as identified, so that we can get slightly more, less jaundiced processing. The audit committee has in the past dealt with issues of significance. For example, the audit committee dealt with in the past the legal issues arising from the High Court judgment, which says the council got it wrong again. I'm sorry, he didn't say again. The council got it wrong. Now, so the audit committee has got that experience. It's got the ability. It hasn't dealt with this issue. And I believe that the suggestion that the audit committee should be integrated into assessing the risk and the risk register as identified for this project is a rational, reasonable one. Thank you, Chair.
Thank you, Chair. I just think it's worth taking a step backwards here as to exactly where we are and what this decision is. The decision that was put in front of Cabinet was to progress a project and to take a step along a project. It is not a decision to in any way identify or build or make a decision as to the actual practical moving ahead with the leisure park. It is part of a process. And there is a discussion around here which sort of leaves me a little bit confused. Very much the case is that there will be further test points within this project as it comes live, and whether that's at planning or committee or other policy committees. And at those stage, there will be significant tests as to the validity of risk and the mitigating issues around it. This risk document is at a time which a decision is being made to go forward with a partner to make progress in a project. It does not define the outcome of that project at all. And it says where are the risks at this particular time against this particular decision. So I think we need to keep this in context as to where we are, because I hear a lot about the wider aspects. Those are not currently on the table. It is fair to say at this particular time, there is no project. And until we enter an agreement with a partner, there is no project to discuss. So from the point of view of what you have in front of you, there's a lot of conceptual documents which say these are directions we could go, which will be tested. And when they're tested in a public domain, then we will come to an answer which will say, actually, this is the real decision. And that decision will be later on in the project life when there is something to discuss. So I feel really, really we need to keep focused on where we are with this. The risks we have, for example, you have a risk identified about the town centre and how to deal with that. And it says in the documents that are being produced, risk has been identified, and at some stage it will need to be dealt with.
Councillor Tait, I need to warn you that this risk register is on pink paper.
Okay.
And so I'd rather you didn't mention anything.
Okay, I will not. My point is that we need to keep this in the context of where we are today and not get dragged off into thinking we're going to discuss something which actually doesn't physically exist currently.
Thank you. Councillor Potter.
I mean, I support, unsurprisingly, you'll say, what the call-in signatories have put to us. And I just think we need to get this into context. I mean, we've heard from you, I think, Chair, that there is a meeting scheduled for not very far ahead. I'm sure the work can be done in that time. And we are not private industry. This is a public body. And the issues of probity come into play, it seems to me, in this regard. I would have thought it's an irresistible proposal, really. Having regard to what our own legal officer, monitoring officer, has said in this regard, simply that the council's risk management policy wasn't followed, I think we want to be absolutely clear that we have measured these risks properly. An internal audit, if there isn't time to get any external audit professional view on this, will, I think, be entirely appropriate and adequate in this regard. I mean, I remind Councillor Tait, I mean, he said at the cabinet meeting, amongst other things, there are plenty of opportunities for this to develop in a negative way. I sincerely hope they won't. Well, what this establishment of the risk register and a development of that will actually prove is just that these risks have been measured and will help Councillor Tait, because he's now going to be the decision maker in the future on this project, to be absolutely confident it's going to develop in a positive way. It seems to me that the delay we'd be talking about is probably only 7 days. And in the context of this massive proposed project, that isn't an unreasonable delay, so that we can be absolutely clear that this scrutiny committee is in receipt of all the information it needs to be and is measuring those risks properly. I mean, the analogy that's made of those who actually prepare the project marking their own homework is just about right in this regard, and that needs a independent view, it seems to me. The monitoring officer, the legal officer, has said as much, it seems to me, in a decision he took about this call-in being successful on that ground. And I recommend to the committee that we take some time out and complete that process. I mean, members opposite can force this through if they want. There's no expedient reason why we should do that. And this delay could be well spent in regard to the probity issues that face us over this contract. Well, you say what contract, but let's be clear about it. In terms of what's been agreed with New River thus far as part of the Cabinet decision for the exclusivity agreement to continue, which is a very special arrangement made in certain circumstances, I think as a scrutiny committee we need to be sure that that's based on solid ground, and I'm yet to be convinced of that.
Thank you, Councillor. Councillor Golding.
Thank you, Chair. I don't actually think it's fair to say that these risks haven't been considered or have only been considered by the project team, because actually they have been considered by Cabinet. The monitoring officer does say that the reports are detailed in the Cabinet report. The issue that the monitoring officer found was that they were not pulled all together into one grid, but they were detailed and they were discussed, and there is actually 10 pages in the Cabinet report that discuss the risks around this project and the appropriate risks at this stage of the decision-making process. Because things like retail and the impact, it very clearly says further studies need to be done. Personally, I feel that's acceptable. I think it's, you know, it also explains that without this agreement in place, people can't do the proper kind of secondary, more in-depth studies, because they don't kind of have the grounds and the legal ability to do so. So I don't think it is fair to say that the risks haven't been considered or evaluated or judged, or have only been done so by the project board. They have been considered by members of this council, and they have agreed that those risks are acceptable. I also don't think it's fair to talk about as if all these risks are financial. I know I can't talk about the risk assessment matrix that we have got, but there are five different categories of risk, and very few of them listed on there are financial. So I think we need to be quite clear that actually the financial implications of this decision are minimum at this stage in the process.
Thank you, Councillor. Councillor Keating.
Thank you, Chair. Can I just refer to a document in the bundle? We got about 500 pages, by the way, in the bundles, which is on a white paper, and it's page 301, and it says draft decision notice. It is proposed that the decision of the cabinet is approve the publication, issue and publication of an award notice to New River Retail, agree to enter a heads of agreement for the redevelopment, agree to enter a development agreement and lease with New River Retail for the leisure park, delegate the agreement to the relevant portfolio holder, I presume it's the current portfolio sitting here now, assemble in principle the use of the compulsory purchase orders. Now, that is a very clear, succinct, precise level of agreement which is before this committee. It is before this committee tonight. And if we can't take that as read, and we're told by the portfolio holder, oh, there's no deal, we haven't got any deal yet. But we'd be approving or not exploring what he is saying here. The cabinet member, the cabinet decision to approve and publish the contract, heads of terms agreement, development agreement. That's what we're talking about. We're talking about the redevelopment of the whole of the leisure park. Now, so there is a proposal. It's quite clearly been dealt with for the last 2.5 years. And we're nearing the end of that proposition. It went to cabinet. The cabinet was proposing to do all of this until such time as the call-in put a stop on events for a short period whilst an examination takes place. Now, it is true that someone has made some effort to identify the level of risk, but they've not identified the fix or the issues that need to be dealt with and that have to be dealt with before the project goes forward. So we either have an examination of those risks and an explanation of them and qualified people looking at them, or we don't. I believe we should. Thank you.
Thank you, Councillor. Councillor Gavin James.
Thank you, Chair. I have to say, in response to Councillor Miller, it's a living document, this risk register. He's right. Everything else I said, I think he was wrong. When you start a project, you look at all the risks that are, you can't deal with the unknowns, of course you can't, but you deal with all the risks that are known, and you look at how you will deal with them. As the project progresses, new risks may emerge, but most of the risks will disappear because you've mitigated them away as the project continues. But you always start with all the possible risks that there are. The idea that you somehow leave things red, leave things barely mitigated, except there's things that might be a risk later on, but we're not going to worry about it until we've signed a legal agreement with a private sector partner, seems a little bit silly, because once you sign that legal agreement, and the heads of terms are all delegated to the legal team and the heads of the portfolio holder, they will agree those heads of terms. To not deal with the risk prior to that point is a very dangerous thing. You may not remember, your vice chair will, Councillor Tay might not remember, but I think Mr. Bovis and Kevin will. The last time we got involved in a large retail scheme, not that this is just retail, of course, we must remember that, although it's hard to tell, was a place called The Mows. And we went into that, and we ended up coming out
a lot worse off financially than we expected. I would be, I think, was it 2 million, 2.1 million? I can't remember if it was 1.8 million. But anyway, it's big money that we ended up costing the taxpayer because we didn't identify risks. Now, some of those risks we may not have been able to identify before. But what was really important when we learned this was that we would go back, we would learn from that experience and make sure we don't get it wrong again, because this scheme is even bigger, which means if we get it wrong, the cost to the taxpayer is even bigger. And we've got the Manydown project coming, which is even bigger, and we get that wrong and we're talking serious money. So I think it's absolutely right that we must do everything we possibly can, whether it takes us a bit longer, to get it right, identify the risks, mitigate those risks, and be fully aware of those risks when we enter into agreement, because it might be a case of, in negotiations with New River, it's part of their help, their role, to make sure they can help mitigate some of these risks as well, because they're our partner. But we must mitigate these risks beforehand, because I don't want to be sitting around this table, or none of us want to be sitting around this table, in a couple of years' time, discussing how we managed to go through this process and not get the leisure park we wanted for our residents and find ourselves out of pocket. 1.8 million is a significant amount of money. You talk about comparing us to the private sector. I know, as someone who's been involved in projects of regeneration in the private sector, if someone lost 1.8 million pounds, they would lose their job and the organisation would go and try and get them back, to get them to pay it back through the courts. We are a public body. We should not accept that when we lose 1.8 million pounds because we didn't manage a project properly, that we'll just carry on with the same routine we did before. We have to learn the lessons. We have to get risk right. The last person, the last portfolio holder, is a warning for Councillor Tait, who was involved in a project that went over budget by 1.8 million, was ended up so embarrassed and ashamed of it, we had to force him into the Houses of Parliament. And Mr. Tait, I'm sure Councillor Tait doesn't want it up there. As a Tory MP, no, it doesn't get any worse than that.
Thank you, Councillor. Councillor Smith.
It's amazing that they didn't end up a Lib Dem MP. But there's only five of them left, isn't there? Sorry, you distracted me, Gavin. That was unfair. Can we just go back to... we're here to discuss the call-in. And I feel like we're discussing lots of other things that aren't quite that. The basis that the call-in was accepted was, as far as I can see, the lack of a risk matrix, which we've now been presented with. The other things I don't disagree need to be debated. Could Councillor Tait please give us a bit of an insight into the risk assessment that's taken place, and perhaps, I believe this went through CEP, so I understand Councillor Keating's call for it all to go to audit, but surely it's already been through the policy process here, as well as going through risk process analysis throughout the council.
Thank you, Councillor. We'll get to Councillor Tait in a minute. Councillor Tilbury.
Yeah, I worked as a project engineer and in project management in large construction projects for many years, and I was often called in as a contractor at the point the contract had all gone hideously wrong. And in every case, when you went through it and when you went through the contract, it had failed because they'd not done a proper risk assessment at the beginning. They either hadn't read the contract properly, they hadn't understood it, and in the worst case, I dealt with the company in Andover, it actually bankrupted the company because they'd entered into about five different 10, 30 million pound contracts, this is 20 years ago, none of which were ever going to make any money. And that was apparent at the beginning. If anyone had actually probably to do a risk assessment of what they were actually getting themselves into, because they didn't understand it. And I think that, unfortunately, I think that's where we are with this, having read through the pink papers. Thank you.
Yes, Councillor Tait.
Thank you. In response to Councillor Smith, the position of the decision and the risk matrix is, in my opinion, as the portfolio holder bringing forward a decision, does the risk matrix support the decision that was being asked to be made at that particular time? And the answer to that, I believe, is yes, it does. And I think it is as complete, and it is a living document, as being pointed out. It will change, it will grow, and it will morph as the project goes along. The decision that we are making as a cabinet was to build the relationship, to go to heads of terms, and eventually to go to develop agreement. It does not say this is what it is beyond conceptually a project which involves the redevelopment of Leisure Park, including a potential development outlet centre. Now, within that, there are going to be a number of risks which have got mitigations already in the risk matrix, which are looking down the line. and which indicate that they will be dealt with, for example, in planning or with more detailed evaluation of shopping trends or whatever else. So there, if I take a thread of that which says, has a risk been identified? Yes. Is it seen as being relevant? Yes, it is. But is it a complete in terms of resolution? No, because there is nothing to do yet until we get to the later part of the project. So the point from my point of view as a decision maker is I look at the risk matrix and I look at the risks and the documents within and say, actually, yeah, does that match the decision we're making to go further with the project with this particular partner? And that's why it was used, and that's why I'm quite happy with the decision that was as it was made. It is true within this living document that things will change in the future, and that it is clear that as we go into a deeper and more accurate interpretation of what this project will be, which may or may not lead it to fail in due course, because if you cannot mitigate the risk, it may be something that's so extreme that the project will fail. But at this particular stage, are we in a position to make a decision that's valid based on what the risks have been identified and where we are, and that's why it was brought forward, and that's why the Cabinet said it was acceptable.
Thank you, Councillor Tait. Is anybody? Yes.
At what point will the other risks you talk about that you're aware of that at this stage these are the relevant risks, is kind of what you're saying. So when are the other risks that you feel we know now will emerge, at what point do you get into the detail? Is that before you sign an agreement that you can't get out of, or do you look in the detail once you've signed an agreement and it's too late to get out of?
Well, I think there are two sets of issues here. One is the risks associated with making an agreement with the company, and then there's a second set of risks which are associated with the project itself in due course. Those two are not always the same.
Okay, does anybody else want to speak about this particular subject, or can we move on? It'll come off your time, Councillor Harvey, okay? Yes, I won't. You won't? Okay. The question. What I'm going to propose is that you do get an opportunity to come back now, and then I want you to reiterate the proposal, please, so that the committee. I will then put it to the committee after some discussion. So carry on.
Thank you, Chair. First thing to say is that the risk matrix that you have in front of you was produced post CEP, post the original Cabinet decision, and was part of these papers, and that was the first time that many members had actually seen the matrix. Full stop. That is the point. The planning. That the legal officer raises, that these matters had not been drawn together in a way and presented to members in the format that they have been. And that's an important point, the format that they had been, such that the risks could be considered from an holistic point of view, rather than mixed in with lots of other commentary and lots of other elements in reports we know the size of here. Now, if you're saying, was the Cabinet decision sound, it is right to ask the question, were those risks appropriately identified, appropriately recorded, appropriately assessed, and that's the word I want to return to in terms of the proposal, assessed, such that the Cabinet should have had the confidence to take the decision. And the reason for the call-in, and our view as signatories, is that the Cabinet should not and did not have the confidence to have proceeded because of that. Now then, that's a matter for discussion and debate, and that's the conversation that needs to be had. But the point here is that some of the risks are in considerable detail and they are not presented as they have been until they have in this matrix. And it's also what lies behind that. It's not just one sheet of A4. I mean, let's talk common sense about this for a second. What we're saying here is that there are significant risks that have been identified that do need to be considered and that need more than 5 minutes at a Cabinet meeting when you're throwing it around the table amongst Cabinet members. If this project is of the scale that we're talking about, a proper assessment of the risks such that the Cabinet can give confidence in the decision they're taking to enter into contractual heads of terms with a developer. And let's not forget, we've already gone through two exclusivity decisions through Cabinet. They've already done the bit in principle. Yes, we like these people. Yes, we think we can do a deal with these people. Yes, we think they've got something going on here. That's Cabinet's view. They've already made those decisions twice before. This is the decision to proceed. Therein, the risks attached to that decision are and should be given weight. That's what we're saying. So the proposal, Chair, is very straightforward. There needs to be an independent assessment of the risks that identifies that backstory, that isn't just one sheet of A4, that can give this committee the confidence that the Cabinet's decision is sound. It's a very straightforward, simple piece of exercise. What are the risks? Have they been properly assessed and understood? Therefore, is the Cabinet decision sound? It's no more complicated than that in the sense. And then the risk analysis, the risk element of that will unpack the issues that may well be matters for concern and matters for raise, as other councillors have suggested. Let's get there first. It's a very straightforward piece of work. And you know, Councillor James is right, Councillor, but all around the table, there may well be more risks to be identified that have not been included thus far. But they are risks, and it's appropriate that they are considered.
Thank you, Councillor. You want to respond to that?
I do.
Okay, well, he'll get the response. He'll be able to respond to that as well.
Yeah, things keep getting said, and I'm not sure whether we're in a questioning phase or whatever else phase we're in currently. You know, you started off which said there'd be a process which says the guests, the speakers, public speakers, I would get a chance to respond. So far, I've just sat here and comments have been made, and I'm feeling that I have to defend each comment as it comes along without having any chance to prepare what I'm trying to say here, and also without listening to the member of the public who's also going to be able to speak. So I'm a little bit concerned as to where we are, and therefore, yes, I do want to respond every time a question comes up, because it's the only time I'm going to get to respond to it.
Well, it isn't the only time. If you recall what I said at the start of the meeting, Councillor Tait, was that there would be an opportunity for you to sum up and an opportunity for the signatories to sum up. What I will say is that I think I've had enough of this a little bit. The proposal is that the risk assessment is risk register is sent to audit for them to review. Can I see all those in favour of that?
Just one point of clarification. I think we need to be clear if we're about to put this to the vote. There's been two proposals put forward. One, we've used general term audit. Some people have referred to the audit team and some people have referred to the audit committee. So I just think we need to be clear what it is that members are voting on. And we need to be clear that if that's the decision, what's going forward, that we are adjourning this evening's meeting for the risk assessment matrix to be independently reviewed by either the audit committee or the audit department.
Councillor Robinson.
Can we just be absolutely clear here about which member of this committee is proposing that resolution?
Councillor Tait. Councillor Tait.
Chair, should we not be reaching a position where we make decisions like this at the end of the debate rather than halfway through it?
Well, the problem is, if a member's put a proposal, then you know we've got to really deal with that proposal. Councillor Potter, are you saying that is your?
Well, can I do that now? Because I understand the point that Councillor Robinson's making. Consistent with what was said by the call-in signatories, I propose that this committee is adjourned and reconvene on a date to be agreed by yourself, Chair. But I think some hint was given about that. I spoke about that when I made a small contribution. And that in that intervening period, the register is referred to internal audit, and for internal audit to do work on that, together with, I think, a number of other risks which so far haven't been included within that register, for that then to come back to us as a committee, probably in 7 days' time, if that's the timetable you're working on, Chair.
So is the proposal that it gets referred to internal audit? Okay, are we all clear that that's the proposal? And that we therefore adjourn this committee and meet again probably next week, which we are anyway. Yes? We're all clear? You're not clear on that? Yeah, it's okay. So we understand what the proposal is. Is there a seconder? Thank you, Councillor Keating. I think I can guess which way this is going. All those in favour of the proposal, please show. All those against? My. Thank you. Right, Councillor Harvey, do you want to carry on with your presentation, please?
Hey, hang on a minute, let me turn the microphone on. Every second will count. The risk analysis and the logs are a fundamental part of any decision-making process. Not simply recording the risks, but also paying heed to what is said. The decision made here does not take account of the risks being identified in a way that allows the executive decision to be considered sound. Let's be clear here. We all want to see the leisure park regenerated for leisure uses that meets the needs and aspirations of our residents, and that is not in question. The process, the way that the decision has been handled, and the procurement and the manner in which New River Retail are now the preferred partner is in question, and the risks attached are crucial. The monitoring officer has acknowledged that the decision made is deficient in respect of adequately covering the risks of this major project. It is worth carefully reflecting, members, on why we are here this evening. The Cabinet wished to regenerate the leisure park. They commissioned Montague Evans to promote the site. The Montague Evans briefing is clear in searching for a leisure partner who can bring forward policy-compliant proposals. From the outset, the framework that was established on what this council sought from partners, including and acknowledging that Montague Evans's brief acknowledged the emerging local plan policy, which was supported by the evidence base of the local plan. That policy wasn't written on the back of a fag packet. It was written with purpose and with reason. Numerous inquiries were made by prospective bidders, and the evidence is clear that those with other ambitions for retail use were put off going further. Those who chose to be transparent from the outset were excluded on the basis that their bids did not conform to the brief. New River was not transparent with members until they had secured the exclusivity decision, and then there was no competition. The bidding process was itself not a level playing field. One bidder, New River Retail, was afforded a meeting with the full project team, another bidder was not. From the start, New River Retail were afforded treatment that any outside observer might consider preferential, and at no point was the risk this created picked up, save for one officer clearly identifying the emerging policies of this council and putting people off bidding as a result of their proposals, obviously not meeting the council's brief. We have to question Montague Evans's approach in this whole process, that it is clear that they stepped outside of their brief, and one can only speculate how they were allowed to do so. The risk, nonetheless, to the soundness of this decision is apparent on the legal advice to the council. Indeed, the evidence suggests Montague Evans actively promoted the retail idea and New River Retail, despite the fact that they did not conform to this council's brief. So who has been driving this? How do we reach a stage that New River Retail is the only bidder and their proposal differs such from the original brief and prospectus? One of our own officers was clear that the proposal might come a cropper if tested against our own local plan policies, and this analysis is as far back as 2013. We see a presentation given by New River Retail to members at stage 2 point, where the bidders were chosen to proceed, in which they set out a wholly leisure-focused proposal. No designer outlet centre is in that presentation. This leisure proposal was the basis of seeing their bid progress to the exclusivity contract. Meanwhile, the idea of retail element had been acknowledged by Montague Evans, and officers were aware of the New River Retail aspiration. Strange then that the proposal we see in December of 2015 from New River Retail had transformed to only accommodate proposals for a larger designer outlet centre, and in fact the largest one in the country. That intervening period of exclusivity based on the original proposals from wholly leisure uses was used to work up the idea that had already been floated to introduce the retail element.
Any other bidder who had failed to get to that stage would have been put off, as we see the evidence suggests other bidders were, because they failed to conform to brief, could feel aggrieved that the New River Retail were allowed to so radically alter their plans, and yet the procurement clock was not reset or the change in this council's position tested again. Who sanctioned New River Retail altering their proposals to run against the brief? Why was this done behind closed doors without wider member involvement? The risk that the decision might be challengeable is therefore very real. New River Retail were given an exclusivity period on the basis of the original proposals, not those they presented in December 2015. Officers extended that exclusivity period, and so New River have been assisted by this council at every stage to reach the proposal they now present us with. No other bidder was afforded such encouragement or support. So the risks associated with the procurement and process of decision making in this council are brought into question. To proceed now with such a risk not being carefully considered and addressed would be foolish. But more than that, it would be beyond the Cabinet's fiduciary responsibilities. Do we all remember the Manydown High Court ruling? I'm sure most members will remember that the judge in that case made it very clear that the executive could not erect Chinese walls between planning and landowning responsibilities, where it was clearly the case that such planning and landowning issues ran together. The Cabinet was found to have acted unlawfully in its decision-making process. The council protested its innocence when members warned the executive that the processes and the way that decisions had been made was dangerous and unlawful, potentially open to challenge. Cabinet pressed on anyway, and they came a cropper. It would be irrational decision-making for the Cabinet to avoid the planning points if relevant to the land owning decision they were making. So who gave permission for New River Retail to proceed in altering their original Stage 2 presentation bid when the changes so clearly ran against the emerging local plan policy? Policy that New River Retail themselves acknowledged they must conform to at that Stage 2 point. The risks in the process being challenged are real and tangible, and we have a duty to public probity and the Nolan principles of openness and transparency. It is clear from the evidence that this process is anything but open and transparent, hence the risks that need to be analysed and considered. It may very well be that if there did turn out to be a challenge by a developer or party which had generally been deterred from participating in the competition, that challenge could succeed based on the procurement process undertaken. It's hard not to conclude that officers at least understood ancillary to mean that the proposed retail products had to be linked to leisure. That point is referenced many times in the evidence. BDBC could therefore be vulnerable to challenge were this decision to proceed as currently presented. If Cabinet are changing the goalposts and wish retail alongside leisure, then they should
Councillor
do so.
Westbrook, you appear to be drifting into contents on the pink papers.
Which item was debated at CEP, that was discussed at CEP.
Yeah, I think it was.
You need to be careful.
Okay, thank you. If Cabinet are changing the goalposts and wish retail alongside leisure, then they should do so openly and transparently and test the market to see the scale of interest in that decision. But to bulldoze on with a clearly challengeable process leaves this council at risk.
Risk also applies to the implications of the proposals brought forward by New River Retail. There is not sufficient evidence provided by New River Retail to convince that achieving an upper-end 300,000 square foot net retail scheme is realistic. Generally, the rents assumed for the leisure uses are very optimistic.
Remove the microphone, Councillor.
And it's acknowledged that New River Retail do not have a track record as a specialist designer outlet centre field or in the provision of leisure. Now, in light of that, at the present, there are a considerable number of uncertainties regarding scheme delivery and therefore financial outcome. The financial impact on the town centre of some £32.35 million by 2020, that was a figure I used at the CEP meeting. It was used in the retail study at CEP. It's a public figure. It's in white.
You've got it in white?
Yeah, it's in white. It's all in white. That was openly discussed at the CEP meeting. New River came to the table, we debated it with the retail experts, sat there. The financial impact on the town centre...
Unless there's anything contrary to that, they're going to carry on. So you've got your chance now to show that it is...
It was openly debated at the CEP meeting.
Okay, no, you can't. Carry on.
The sum of £32.35 million by 2020 does raise concerns as to the potential loss of shoppers to the proposed designer outlet centre from our town centre. We have already seen significant issues raised by traders in the town about the need to invest directly in our town centre and not to create further competition to it. The suggestion is that the retail use would be complementary, but what we do know that is that during
Councillor
the CEP meeting...
Sorry, my legal officers want to hang on a second, they want to check something. We're just looking to see whether some of the stuff that you're currently talking about is restricted, and if it is, then the committee will need to pass the resolution.
It can't be restricted because it was debated openly on the public session of CEP meeting, therefore I'm entitled to speak about it. I'm sorry, okay, well it's been in public already.
Okay, well, I don't know quite how I'm going to check that. But is that Steve?
Chairman, if I might help. Yes, indeed, Councillor Harvey's correct. That figure was used at the CEP meeting, and unfortunately members weren't made aware at that time that that figure exists in the pink papers. However, I would counsel against, but clearly you wish to seek legal advice as to whether we should return to that matter on in white session or turn to pink session if you wish to discuss that impact in detail.
Sorry? That's very helpful, thank you. Carry on with that in mind.
Thank you, Chair.
Have to stop again.
I'm discussing the matters that have been raised publicly. New Retail River's supporting documents do not consider the likely operator. Now, the critical issue here is determining outlet centre performance and whether it will work or not. So great care needs to be taken on the assumptions underpinning the BDO, the Basic Stoke Designer Outlet Centre. There is a critical but unresolved question concerning the operator that needs to be resolved, and the suggested brand lineup is either largely unrealistic or is it appropriate? We discussed that at CEP in the context of the people they sought and could be seeking to bring to this particular BDO. And the brand issues is important because it should be reviewed and the risk element should be reviewed independently by experts. If I quote from the public papers, the evidence submitted by the New River Retail and Cartage owners in support of the BDO relies upon top-down assumptions of performance, drawn largely from anecdotal evidence from around the UK. In reality, the quality of catchment and the strength of competition and the quality of operator determines the quality of brands, and this in turn will drive the performance of the outlet centre. To date, a thorough assessment of the commercial trading potential has not been provided to BDBC. The issues surrounding the responsibility of Cabinet to protect this council's interests, for example in the malls, let alone Festival Place, or the town centre, the top of town, again place a strong emphasis on the fiduciary responsibility of the council. To proceed with such risks is so clearly identified, if not unanswered, would be reckless. Our own office has acknowledged that should New River Retail Designer Outlet Centre vision prove not possible, not viable, then the whole scheme would in all likelihood not proceed. The New River Retail want to secure a much higher percentage of pre-lets, as acknowledged at the CEP meeting, that the business model is unproven and that the size proposed is nearly 40% bigger than the next largest designer outlet centre in the country. Therein, the risks to the sustainability and viability of the project are very real.
If we return to the risk log on page 339, you can see level of risk already partially identified. This list is not exhaustive of the issues we have raised and is also scored by the project team. Transport, land use, financial, commercial, the risks are clear throughout the process to date. In order to have any confidence moving forward before legal agreements are entered into, we need to be assured that the risks are considered and mitigated against. And if it transpired that those risks are too great, then we need the honesty to say that this decision should not be progressed, and we look to reset our process in order to find a partner in the market willing to work with us properly. In other major projects, we have seen the risk log handled very differently, with clear attention to detail and focus on the issues presented. Further, for example, on Manydown, this council has sought independent risk impact advice, such that the issues can be openly and transparently identified and addressed. This process has given all members confidence that the process officers are following is assessing and progressing mitigation as work builds. The sense of transparency and openness is clear. There are a number of internal matters that need careful examination. The actions of our property services department need to be reviewed. How was the process allowed to get to a stage where a legal challenge could be made? The way they have acted alongside New River Retail, facilitating them, is a serious question. The conduct of the cabinet member in whose responsibility the leisure park rests at the time also raises concerns. That he sat in the CEP meeting opposite a colleague from Montague Evans is a matter for concern in the decision-making process. That his advice was sought by the leader during the decision-making meeting that led to this call-in also raises key concerns about the risk and therein the soundness of the decision.
The issues we raise here on risk and impact of the proposals from New River Retail and the way that this council has left itself vulnerable to challenge, the way that the procurement process was allowed to develop, all need addressing carefully. That internal audit should review the decision in light of these concerns and with a mind to appreciating the risk that this council face is essential. That this scrutiny committee should see that work and that the way the risks have been addressed, not on one side of A4 in a simple table, but like with other major decisions, in the form of substantive work that picks up the concerns. Here we're talking about legal, financial, commercial, sustainability and process risks, amongst others. The transport risk, for example. We know that HCC have not factored in transport movements of the leisure park on Manydown, or understood the implications of the workforce seeking to get to the site, or shoppers or leisure users seeking to park either. Think about the impact on Winkleberry, for example, in terms of local parking. At the moment, highways are suggesting that most of the movements are going to be off-peak, so no account of the workforce then on site. Make no mistake, the impact on the roads through Hatch Warren or Kempshot will be great, as well as through Buckskin and South Ham. All the traffic modelling in the world can't account for the natural behaviour of drivers, and they will find the shortest and fastest routes from a junction to the site. We've been told that people will park and ride, but there is no park and ride. We've been told that people will go and get park off-site, and they'll park their nice cars off-site, they'll get on a bus and go to their leisure park via the bus services to buy their nice designer products. The transport risks are huge and need to be considered not simply in planning terms, but also from a landowner point of view in the consequence of the decision that this council is seeking to make. The consequences for viability and sustainability of the decision are very relevant to this cabinet decision to proceed to heads of legal terms. Let's be clear, if you proceed with this decision, then each member around this table, as with the Manydown decision, would be ignoring these genuine and legitimate concerns. The monitoring office has commented about the risk register and the risk policy. What we're looking for from this committee to help the cabinet make a better decision is that it protects this council. After all, it was this council's record in the High Court is not a good one when it comes to these issues. Just keeping this simple, there are obvious substantive concerns with the decision that need to be addressed before it should or could proceed. I'd like to ask this committee if any of its members have ever actually seen so much pink paper. 80% of the cabinet papers are on pink, 80% of the call-in agenda is on pink, and nearly 100% of the supplemental agenda is on pink. So much pink in something so public is why we're here tonight. Add to that the number of redactions. Fascinating that members are seeing redactions on pink papers, even not in the white papers, but on the pink papers. And if I didn't know better, I'd say there was quite an awful lot more here to uncover and look at, and somebody was trying to hide something. There is an awful lot here that needs to be examined properly in the right place with the right evidence in front of us and the risks properly assessed. And Chair, that's our submission so far.
Thank you very much. I think it might be sensible to let Mr. Dawson come and give his little his 2 minutes, and then committee will get a chance to question the signatories. Are we okay with that? He's been sat there rather well for an hour and a quarter. Mr. Dawson, it's Mr. Edward Dawson, isn't it? Thank you. You're going to get 2 minutes. If you look as though you're almost finishing, I will let it go on. I don't want to prevent you, and since you're the only public speaker, we can be magnanimous in our gratitude. Push the button.
Are we here? Okay, thank you, sir, for allowing me to speak. I'm here simply as a member of the public, not representing any organisation, but I followed these matters in the local press. And my concern arises because I think that there has been little or no public discussion or consideration of the matter of the redevelopment of the Basingstoke Leisure Park. I heard the discussion over the past hour or so with considerable interest, and I believe that the council does need to have greater clarity and vision about what it seeks for the leisure park, and that should be open to public discussion. It should be promoted by the council. It's done it before on other things. I was involved in the local plan process and with the inspector in these premises for some time, and I know what was said there about this scheme. In general terms, there it is, but it does refer to a no detriment. I'm looking at the paper here, it is white. No adverse impact on existing retail facilities in the town. I believe that the public has not commented on the importance of the top of town, of Festival Place. I look at page 33 of the council documents here. It talks about in these areas we have world-class facilities, the Anvil and the Willis Museum. Well, much though I love the Willis Museum, it's a local museum, sir. And to talk about, in other respects, about the facilities that are already here, seems to me, with respect, the council is believing its own propaganda, which I think is unfortunate. I would like to see a preferred partner, if there is a preferred partner, to come along here and be grilled by the public, not just by elected members, face the public and have some grilling as to what they wish to pursue. I also think that there are far too many pink papers and that they don't need to be in confidential, that they should be looked at. I don't understand how we can have pink papers ahead of a final decision made on the preferred partner. I really don't see, after, once a decision has been made and confirmed, then fine, I can understand the need for confidentiality, but before then, really I can't. So I'm concerned not so much with the process, I hope I've got a moment left, as the substantive issues, and I'm concerned to hear the officers tell us that the Internal Audit Board, which I assume is an officer group, is going to look at it. These matters are for members to decide, sir, not for internal officer groups to check the process is right or not. I'm sure the process is right. But the substantive decisions, and we heard the debate earlier on, I believe have not been made. I think the impact on the other retail areas is likely to be considerable. A negative impact that we should consider, not simply in terms of risks in quote, but in terms of the vision that the public and the elected members wish to see for Basingstoke. So I hope that the committee tonight will agree that this goes back to Cabinet for further consideration. Thank you, sir.
Thank you, Mr. Dawson. Stay there because there may well be some questions. Could you just push the button on the? That's it. We do actually have the Anvil is a world-class auditorium. It's one of the top five in the world. Just so, you know, to clarify.
The Willis Museum is
undoubtedly world-class.
I love the Willis, but I wouldn't say that.
Okay. Members like to respond? Does anybody want to ask Mr. Dawson any questions? No. Mr. Dawson, thank you so much. You've certainly told us what to do, which is very helpful. Thank you. And if you wish to stay for the rest of the meeting, you're very welcome. Unless, of course, we have to discuss pink papers, in which case you'll be out on your ear. But thank you. Can I just remind us all about the status of the pink papers? I've got to get back to where we are now. Have members got any questions of the signatories before I invite the cabinet member to respond? No. Okay, Councillor Tait, would you like to respond?
Yes, I think I would. I'm glad that we start from a principle which says the goal of redeveloping the leisure park is one which we all share. It would be frightening if we didn't share that, because the amount of smoke and energy that's been expended when we're agreeing is interesting compared to how much we would expend if we were disagreeing. I'm a little disappointed in some of the comments that were made, particularly at the end of the presentation from the signatories. And I think it is somewhat unbecoming to make aspersions on members or people who either A, are not here to defend themselves or whatever, but fundamentally that if you're going to do that, you really ought to produce some evidence apart from continuing to make an allegation or make some comment that is unproven, frankly. And I think that that's a little unbecoming, and it does the argument no good overall.
I think you've got to get to the point.
I'll get to the point. It'll take a little time.
Okay, well, I'm happy for you to take the point, but, you know, you've spent the first few minutes
criticising. I'm going to take some time, Chair.
Okay.
I mean, I've at the other side, I've had some time. I think it's fair, do you know? Yeah. So, going back to where we are, we're in a position where we are scrutinising a decision of Cabinet to enter heads of terms, to negotiate the heads of terms and reach a developer agreement with a partner. That's the decision. The call-in was made, and from my reading of the document, from the legal document, it says from the officers that actually risk was brought to Cabinet. It's in the papers, and the issue that the scrutiny succeeded on was that a risk matrix was not attached to the decision, and it says that that's indicated that perhaps a systematic approach to the risk management should be undertaken and identified, and that's the issue that we're here discussing tonight. We seem to have heard a lot more about other risks and other issues, but actually that's clear that within the Cabinet decision that was made, that was included in the papers, which were pink or otherwise, and that therefore have been read and understood by Cabinet, and therefore Cabinet, even though it did not have a risk matrix in the sense of the word that you have seen in front of you today, that actually Cabinet understood the decision that it was making. So it's not a perverse decision. And that is the opinion that came with it. So a lot of you made of, you know, did Cabinet understand what it was doing? Cabinet had the papers, understood the papers, risk was in them, identified and was therefore understood and was part of the decision. And I think that's really quite important, because the issue here is, was a risk matrix attached? The answer clearly was not. This is the risk matrix that applied for that decision at that particular time. It is not the risk matrix that will end up being a risk matrix in 6 months' time as this becomes a different stage of project. So it will evolve, as has been said by members. So the point we're at is that, was risk understood? I believe it was, and that seems to be sustained by the monitoring officer. The issue here is none of the other issues as part of this discussion. The issue here is, was that risk matrix attached? The answer is it was not. So fair enough, that needs to be done both now and in the future. After that, we should be talking about the real issues here for the future. The future of the legislature, not at the scrutiny meeting, but as it comes into a discussion, which comes into planning, which becomes into policy meetings, then we will see a lot more identity of risk and mitigation, understanding how that will become part of a completed project. Frankly, after that, we should be just concentrating purely on the issue we've got in hand. And I appreciate all the comments that have been made. A lot of them are well-meant and well-meaning, but fundamentally, they're not part of this discussion as far as I am concerned.
Councillor Tait mentioned that he was entitled to his response because this is a bit, but this is a scrutiny committee. I don't know if anyone's been to a thing called a cabinet meeting. It's a little show we put on once a month where members can come up with very valid points, are limited to 4 minutes. And no matter how those points get misinterpreted by the members of the cabinet, they've had their 4 minutes, they're not entitled to intervene. The scrutiny committee is serving a function for the opposition members to scrutinise the work of the cabinet. It's the unique and only committee where the cabinet member might have to sit and listen more than he can talk. And I just raise that point.
Thank you, Councillor James. Councillor Miller. We're not going to get into an argument about the Constitution here, are we?
No, sir, we're not. I thank Councillor Tait for his explanation. And we've heard the debate. I've heard his views. I'd like to propose that we take no further action on this particular call-in. I think it has been satisfactorily answered.
Have I got to do it? Okay, well, firstly, is there a seconder for that proposal? Okay, thank you. I'll come to you in a moment, Councillor Keating. I get the feeling that it probably hasn't been debated enough, and I also don't think that, you know, we've kept our member of the public waiting. He made some points which I think deserve a response from the cabinet member. So from that perspective, no, I don't agree. Councillor Keating.
Thank you, Chair. To suggest cutting short a call-in before we've even really started is really irresponsible. Yeah. Just because the Tories on this committee have a built-in majority does not give them the right to say, we will decide an hour or so into a call-in that we'll stop it here and now. The reality is, calling is a legal, constitutional process by which Cabinet is called to account. And that's what we are supposed to be doing. We've hardly started. within the last 5 minutes, the signatories have just finished putting their case. There has been no discussion of that case so far, and Councillor Miller now wants to truncate any discussions. I can tell you, if we're going to be irresponsible about cabinet decisions, and we're going to be irresponsible about scrutiny, then we might have pack up and go home. Thank you.
Councillor Miller, I would like you to withdraw the proposal.
I will not, Chair, because the call-in, as advised by the monitoring officer, was to do with the production of a risk matrix, and that was explained in adequate terms by the portfolio holder.
Hang on a minute, Councillor James. Yes, please.
I just want to clarify this point because it is around the report of the monitoring officer. I'm sure Gary will step in if he considers it's necessary, sat next to me today. The ground of call-in that was permitted this evening relates to the incomplete risk assessment. It wasn't in there, and the policy requires a risk assessment to be included. But the policy also requires us to ensure that all risks are drawn together and adequately considered in terms of likelihood, ranking, and specific mitigation. That's what the policy requirement is. That's the point that the monitoring officer was making when allowing this call-in. My recommendation to you today as a committee is that discussion is held around that specific point, and it does need to be around that specific point. It's not just about pulling a document out and saying it was done. It wasn't in the right format. And it might be, Councillor Tait, that you believe that all of this was addressed in the report, and that's why you're happy that this has been dealt with. Members may have comments that things in the report haven't been picked up in the matrix, or there might be just general comments. The whole idea of this meeting is let's get somewhere where we can say everybody's happy that risk has been assessed appropriately before the decision has been made. That should be, and Councillor Tait, you might be satisfied that position, but I do think members should be given an opportunity to say what it is about risk that they believe is lacking in that report.
Councillor Miller.
I wish I'd heard those words at the beginning of this committee meeting. I will let my proposal lie on the table and allow you to, I can't allow you to do anything. You make your own mind up, Chair. But I would like that proposal to lie on the table at the moment.
Thank you. That's gracious. Thank you very much. We are at the point when the relevant director can provide additional background. I don't know whether either you, Laura, or Mike want to do that. Well, there won't be another chance. Okay. Has anybody got any questions they want to ask directly of Councillor Tait? Yep. Councillor Smith, then Councillor Potter, then Councillor Keating, I think. Yes, Councillor.
Can I ask Councillor Tait just for some clarity? Obviously, we've heard lots about the risk matrix. The risk was built into the report. I think fairly signatories suggested that it was at times lost in the report. Did a risk matrix exist but wasn't attached, wasn't part of it? Had the risk matrix not been done? How exactly, and is a risk matrix a new document or is it an old document that has been updated?
Well, the risk matrix exists. It was not attached to it, and risks have been evaluated within it. So at the point of time where the cabinet report was produced, a risk matrix existed. And it has been reformatted as it's grown, and it exists in this current format as it is now.
Can I have the briefest follow-up and just ask, the risk assessment we see, understanding we can't go into it because it's on the pink paper, is that as of the publication of this, or is that as of when the decision was made by Cabinet?
April. So that's what just...
It was done before.
Yeah, slightly before the Cabinet decision.
Councillor Potter.
I wonder if I could just raise a matter with Councillor Tait and ask for his comments. I mean, because he was saying, amongst other things, how concerned he was at the comments made by the signatories regarding his absent cabinet colleague, Councillor Isa, in the way that they were presumably impugning something. But would Councillor Tait accept that Councillor Isaac includes within his register of members' interest the fact that he is a partner in Montague Evans, albeit brackets, cabinet, sorry, consultant, and therefore is linked directly to the company that's given advice to this council.
Councillor Potter, I am advised that this isn't relevant for,
well,
for this meeting.
Well, with respect, Chair, I mean, it's Councillor Tait saying that type of comment should not be said, implied. All I'm stating is a fact, I think, isn't it?
Okay, well, okay. We can record the fact, certainly.
Moving on, can I just also, I mean, I think Edward Dawson made a very valid point, really, in regard to the lack of public consultation over this major proposal, regarding the fact that fundamentally the project is changing in its concept, that the leisure park that the people of Basingstoke have enjoyed thus far will change fundamentally if this scheme proceeds. And I would have thought it was a key part of the way Basingstoke and Deane Council has hitherto conducted itself to embrace the public comments on such a major proposal. Does he have any view why this hasn't happened up to date?
Thank you. Sorry, I can't see this. Councillor Keating. Put it up there.
Thank you, Chair. First of all, wearing my experienced hat of an audit committee member, I know that when you go to an audit committee and you get a statement of risk which shows red and amber but no green, that you have to understand that red means stop. It's not red and amber and green for you know, just colour reasons. It's to give an indication to the public and to the members that things are so serious you can't just go ahead and forget the risk. If it's red, you can't just go ahead and forget it. Amber means it's a serious concern. And again, you shouldn't go ahead without mitigation. Let me just give you an example of what I'm talking about. On item 9 on this particular register, right?
Sorry.
No, I'm not having quoted the word for it, have I?
I don't know. Just reminding you it's pink, Councillor Keating.
I know it's pink. Look, it's pink. I got this evening from an officer of this council. It's not on pink, but I do understand what you're saying, because it was produced in pink.
This job's difficult enough without you.
Right? But the issue raised that is really of considerable concern is, it says, yeah, there is a concern, there is an issue, it's red, and mitigation is possible. That's what it says, mitigation is possible. No solution. It says, here's a showstopper, it's red, you can't go forward, mitigation is possible, end of story. That's not what risk registers are supposed to do. They're supposed to say, this is a showstopper, there is mitigation, and this is what we will do to mitigate that risk. That's not done. That is not what's happening here. And the similar concern attaches to the other risks identified as either hugely significant showstoppers or seriously concerning, and there is no actual mitigation identified or proposed. If you identify a risk and do not propose remedial mitigation, then you shouldn't go forward, full stop. That's what audit committee training tells you. Now, can I...
Well, hang on, Councillor Keating. This part of the... Before we go to a general discussion was whether there are any questions of the signatories. And I've established that. Are there any questions for the portfolio holder?
Yes, I was going to get onto that.
Were you?
But that was one point that really is significant.
So you're going to go to it now, are you?
If you don't mind.
Well, I don't mind.
Okay, thank you. The next question for Councillor Tait is, what mitigation have you taken, or do you intend to take, before signing an irrevocable agreement, to identify the remedial measures to protect the interests of the retail sector in the town centre from the impact of the design outlet centre? There is a risk, we know that. What are you going to do about that risk? That's one question. The next question, separately, is, are you aware that New River Retail has got no experience whatsoever in running or organising or developing a designer centre? Are you aware of that? And the next question is, will there be car parking under New Leisure Park? Car parking charges, should I say? Because there is some confusion in the paperwork that I've read. Some people said that there will be car parking charges, and some people say that there won't. And the final point is, to go back to Mr. Dawson's point, is, are you intending to consult the public before signing any agreement about the whole of the leisure park? Are you intending to consult the public afterwards? Thank you.
Councillor Tate.
So, firstly, answer to your question, New River Retail, yes, I am aware. That's a straightforward answer to your question. I'm aware of their experience, and I would... of their experience, and that they are a highly successful development organisation. As far as the parking charges are concerned, there is no decision, because there is no project finished which will end up being decided upon. So I can't actually answer your question, in all honesty. As far as consultation is concerned, consultation will be part of the development process, and ultimately, when it becomes part of a planning application, clearly there is a plan for consultation to get to that on what the final project will look like. As I said to you earlier, this is a period where we have a conceptual plan of how to go ahead, and that it's subject to considerable test as it goes along, and considerable test will be about issues of viability and also effect, and those could change ultimately the nature and could actually halt a program like this. So I think there is a considerable amount of consultation and also development before it gets to the LPA. There are some mitigations. I mean, part of answering your question, to be honest, is in the pink papers. And from that point of view, it's difficult, but fundamentally, the issues that you're talking about will become part of the next stage of the project, for sure. I mean, they have to, because as it comes before a planning authority, they will need to be answered. And it would be wrong of me to prejudge what those answers would be. I'm not in a position to do that. And frankly, at this stage, all you can do is comment that the concept allows us to see that potentially we can end up with a development program for the leisure park in conjunction with a designer outlet centre, which has been the process, the programme that's been put forward by New River Retail. So I think that, you know, consultation will have its place, absolutely. And consultation will take part in many forms, I'm sure, as it has on other projects that we're currently doing. And that will come as there is something which is to be consulted about.
You certainly have answered the questions I've asked. Your answers, of course, are totally unsatisfactory, because you're talking about signing a deal first.
Thank you. Councillor James.
Thank you, Chair. Really just a couple of questions, because I think everything else we start straight into a pink world. But
can I just in a second. If we need to do that, we can.
Yeah, I think it's better to get the white paper out of the way, because once the public go home, we probably can't get them back and avoid pink if we can for as long as possible. But I accept if the answer to the question may include the word pink. obviously, one of the risks is if we don't proceed, and there seems to be some pace about the speed we're moving to get this. Bear in mind, we didn't have a huge amount of interest initially when we went out to tender looking for a partner. We've got one, we've had exclusivity, and now we're pushing ahead with that one partner rather than thinking, we've got a new scheme now, it's changed, let's re-tender and invite others to submit alternatives. So we're also moving at pace. Is that something to do with the current condition of, I keep wanting to call it the Lido, but I'm old, Aquadrome and the ice rink? Because obviously a lot of this is motivated by the fact those buildings have a lifespan. I'd be like to know what that lifespan is, and obviously you can't give detailed information, but are we talking we have to do something within the next year or two because the buildings will start having health and safety notices stamped up outside? Or are we saying that actually the buildings could be kept in a good state of repair for another 10 years, so we could take some time with this? And also, in terms of those timescales, were the Cabinet given the information in order to, because obviously it's important for them to decide whether they've got a time constraint or not in terms of making this decision. Were the Cabinet aware of what the condition of those leisure existing main leisure facilities are and how long before they expire their purposeful use?
The question as far as timing is concerned, the reality of the marketplace is the driver here, that there is an opportunity which has been presented to us which allows us to undertake one element of the work that this borough wants to do, which is to redevelop its leisure park. And that has been produced by a company who've put forward a product, a development outlet centre. Now, it's a competitive market in the property marketplace. And the reality is that we are presented with an opportunity that occurs because there is a gap in the marketplace. And that gap will close in due course, either because the market moves on or it makes a decision to do something else completely. So the driver is really, for where we are, is about the opportunity. Yes, it is true that our buildings currently are in, will be in need of work in due course. I can't comment on the ice rink because it's a private matter for the ice rink. And I believe that the Aquadrome is covered in the report. So from the point of view of did Cabinet know, Cabinet have an information in front of them which says this is part of your decision. But the timer driving here is the reality of the marketplace. And let's be quite clear that we're not the only show in town that was capable of hosting a designer outlet center. And that in the commercial world, that there is a need to move on apace on the grounds that if there is no pace, a company will move away and do something else. That may be good, that may be bad, but we have to be aware of that. And as a Cabinet, it's clearly part of the decision to do the best for the borough, and that means taking advantage of opportunities as they come along. So I would suggest that the timing of this is much to do with the marketplace and where we are and what position the market's in as the key issue here.
Very, very important information that they've given us there, because we embarked on this originally, and I sat on the map and was there when next to Councillor Harvey when New River came along. We were told when we went out to tender, the original spec was we want to regenerate the leisure park and we're looking at what can be done. We went out to tender, there was a limited response. We are now presented with a decision, a proposal by New River, which includes a heavy outlet, designer outlet centre element. You've just said the reason for pace and speed is because we have an opportunity that someone else may take. So the Cabinet's focus is no longer on regenerating the leisure park, but on building capacity for a designer outlet centre. Because that's what you said, the reason for pace was, we've got to get an outlet centre before someone else does, and the leisure park thing seems to be lost. But that's your words.
Okay. at risk of being misinterpreted, what I'm saying is the opportunity has been created for the leisure park to be redeveloped, and as part of that project there's a development outlet centre. The development outlet centre concept is something which is a competitive marketplace, and therefore we need to be aware of what's happening in a competitive market as we make decisions. But I'm in no way saying that that's changed anything. The core issue here is the redevelopment of the leisure park, and secondarily is looking at the size. We're talking 300,000 on the maximum of 300,000, I think, on the design or outlet, and 600,000 on the leisure park. So if I didn't communicate properly, the issue here is the competitive nature of the marketplace and how we utilize our the offering to do what we need to do, which is to build and redevelop the leisure park.
Because it's not about risk. I'll come back to you. Councillor Robinson.
Thank you, Chairman. Can I ask the portfolio holder, we've heard from the signatories that clearly a risk matrix was not attached. But despite that, it appears that the risks were considered by CEP, by the Office of Programme Board, and by Cabinet. Do you feel that despite the risk matrix being produced in one document, that you as the decision maker were adequately informed of the risks present?
Yes, I do feel that that's the case. And when I've looked at the risk matrix and referenced against the reports, then I can see that the reports and the matrix collide. And therefore, I look at it and think, well, actually, yes, I think I have seen a balance between the two. And yes, it was not attached, but actually, yes, I did have adequate vision of the risks.
Thank you. Councillor Potter.
I mean, with your indulgence, can I just put a couple of things to Councillor Tait about transport and access to the facility, and move on to a question at the end? Simply, I attended a highways briefing. Councillor Miller was there a few days ago, the Highway Authority, at which they had some information for us regarding improvements in the west of the town, which includes the Thornycroft roundabout. And I really just want to know where some of the sort of muddled thinking is occurring in this regard. I mean, what we heard was that in regard to this complex, those who are working on this, and I know comments will be made about all this will resolve itself during the planning application stage, but this is the way people are thinking, it appears, at the present time. And I know Councillor Harvey made mention of this, is that the majority of the journeys that take place are going to be off-peak, whatever that may be, albeit we've got 2,400 new jobs going to be created in this complex. And that in regard to parking, albeit we're advertising this, it's being talked about as this regional centre that's going to attract people 50, 60 miles away to come in and see this new designer outlet, take part in this designer outlet. Those people will be encouraged actually not to come in by car and park their car somewhere else and come in on a bus facility, which isn't included within the plan in any case. I just want to know where this sort of muddled thinking is taking place regarding the integrity of the proposals. And this is on white paper as well, by the way, went to Cabinet. And also, if we are talking about that flow of traffic coming into this complex, that it will be, quote, necessary to restrict access through some of the feeder roads, through Buckskin, through Kempshott, through South Ham. How on earth anybody can consider that you can isolate cars that are coming into the designer outlet as against any other traffic defies logic, I think, really. But that's actually quoted within the original report that went to Cabinet. I just want to know really what the thinking is on this, really, for this major facility and some of the sort of quite confused propositions that have been made regarding the traffic flows and the parking, who's going to be working there at what time. It just doesn't stand the test, it seems to me, and the risks of all of that muddled thinking need to be tested properly, and they haven't been up to now.
Thank you. I'm assuming that that's a transport-based risk that you're asking a question on. Councillor Tait.
Well, with risk of repetition, you know, there will be more in-depth traffic survey and management planning of it as the project becomes something that comes before local planning. However, already there is work going on with Hampshire County Council, the LEP, the borough. So it's not true to say there's nothing happening, but maybe that's not what you're saying, but there is an awareness of some of the issues already. And mitigation, or you know, give you a simple example, that there is already a discussion taking place about the changing of sat-nav presets so that people are not using their sat-navs and being driven through what becomes a rat-run area. So without going into a huge, you know, the detail of something that doesn't actually have a lot of detail, it is an issue that's been put forward as a risk, and there is a, you know, there will be a working through this to provide an outcome which will mitigate it. What I'm indicating to you, it is already visible with those that are concerned that this is an issue that needs to be resolved adequately before it becomes a planning authority issue.
Thank you. The position we're in at the moment is if we want to now move to pink paper, and we'd have to pass a resolution and ask the public to leave, is there a desire for that? Are there questions that members wish to raise that would require reference to the pink pages? You don't think so till you ask, that's helpful. No? Okay, good. Are there any more questions for either the signatories or the cabinet member? Yes, sorry, beg your pardon, I forgot.
It's another transport issue, but the other side of town. There's obviously a risk in the regeneration to the park and ride scheme used by many a commuter, which means that the town centre car parking is free for shoppers. So there is a risk that if that facility goes, or indeed charging is allowed on those car parks in the leisure park, it becomes obvious to park in town instead. There's further economic risk to the town centre, also a massive traffic risk, and also a big parking risk to the town centre, and more cars coming into the town centre. Obviously, as a town centre resident, worker and representative, that risk to me is fundamental and critical, because it's further damage to the town centre economy that could be done. How detailed a risk have you taken in? If you do move the park and ride scheme, where is it going to park and ride from? And what are you doing to protect the roads and deal with the extra traffic that's come into the town centre, particularly the clogging up of car parks all day and the impact that will have on the trade in the town centre?
If you refer to risk 15, you will find that there is a discussion of that. And also in the centre shuttle will be under risk 15, 8.1 will be retained. So again, talking in the point of, is this part of the discussion and evaluation? The answer is yes, it is, and the risk has been identified that there is something to be done about it. But it cannot finish with a final mitigated solution, because we're not in a position where we have a final project plan with a final project that is a development that's capable of being evaluated. So the point is, where are we? It is in a point where it is acknowledged as part of the risk, and there is a process which will go through as it becomes something that it becomes a planning application. So from the point of view of within the risk, is it there? Yes, it is.
Sorry, we can't wait to hear your deep concerns.
The concern is that we can't do all these things until planning. Well, once it gets to the planning stage and you go before a planning committee, you can't then say, yes, you're quite right, looking at that, we will need an extra car park. Let's find 20,000 square foot and tarmac it now in the town centre, because there isn't any areas like that. You need to plan. All these risks have to be dealt with long before planning, before you even sign up to the scheme. If the scheme's going to fail, we're saying we'll deal with the risk of planning.
Councillor James.
That's really scary.
Yeah.
And incompetent.
Thank you. But was there a question in there?
No, I was just picking up on the ridiculous point that we made, that we're not going to deal with risk until planning.
Okay. Fair point. Thank you. Do you wish to respond?
Just go back, you know, there is a risk that's been identified, and the development of the resolution of those risks develops as it moves forward into planning.
Thank you. No more questions? Oh, Councillor Keating, Councillor Faulkner. Councillor Keating, then.
I'm going to ask this question against the background of being told there is no project. Now, I've got a cabinet decision notice here in front of me, which we're scrutinising. And it's intended by the cabinet member to take this to cabinet next week or the week after and get it approved. That's the process that we're involved in. Now, when we have signed the award notice, the contract award notice, the heads of terms with New River Retail agree the development agreement with respect to the leisure park redevelopment, will we be able to go back and say, oh, sorry, you haven't mitigated the risk, we'll stop? Will we be committed to it? Could I have a clean, simple answer, please? Will we be committed to the project?
Thank you. It has already been to the cabinet, Councillor Keating. All right, okay, fair enough, yeah.
Legal obligation is on the signing of a development agreement, not before. Subject to the completion of heads of terms.
Excuse me, Chair, please. It really is nonsense to tell experienced councillors, agree all of that, but there is no project. It really is a nonsense. And to suggest otherwise is misleading, misleading to the extent that it's pejorative.
Question.
The question is, why can't I get a straight answer? If we sign all of these, will we be able to get out of the contract? Should we wish to?
So there is a question there, Councillor Tate.
It's probably worth explaining that the next step would be to agree legal documentation, which is a development agreement, a lease, and an agreement for lease. And that is months worth of work, literally. These things take a long time. And on completion of those agreements, and that would be have to go back to the portfolio holder for that approval, that would be legally binding, at that stage. And could you get out of it? No, unless New River then don't deliver on the various conditions that will be built into that those legal agreements.
Thank you. Councillor Faulkner. I'll call Councillor Faulkner. I'll come back to you, Councillor Keating.
Thank you. Yes, I've been sitting here quite quietly all night because, I don't have the benefit of the historical knowledge of some of the things that have been said. So I suppose several people here can only read and listen to what's being said and proposed, etc. I think the question I have goes back to the signatories, really, that I found the tone of this debate tonight somewhat disturbing. And some of the things that have been said, I felt uncomfortable. And yes, I've got a big business background, and therefore, if I were looking at this, I'd say, what is the risk to our existing partner, who might be the only person watching this on the web, and what message does this send to any future partner? Because I just feel that some of this is just a bit too negative, to be frank.
So that was a question to the cabinet member or to the signatories? Okay. Would you like to come and respond to that, signatories? Please. And then I'll come back to you, Councillor Keating. Yes.
I mean, I wouldn't say, a proper risk assessment should be undertaken. You know, our own monitor officer says that. I mean, this is not about us being against decisions for the sake of it, rather more about helping the cabinet to make the right decision. We believe the proper risk assessment is carried out now. In the long term, this will reduce the uncertainty facing any potential businesses considering to setting up in Festival Place, for example. You know, we've got many empty shops there at present. You know, and I don't see why you can't go away, do a piece of work, as our own monitoring officer has said. We're signatories, we're councillors, we're not on trial, we're not experts, and we're asking you to make the decision to go away and have a look at it. It's not about being negative. We started off when we spoke at CEP as councillors, we've spoken at Cabinet, we're speaking tonight, we've looked at it, we've read all this, we brought this here for very good reason. And it's not about being negative, it's not about wanting a successful leisure park for the residents of Basingstoke. From our point of view, it's not what it started out as. It's changed, it's completely changed. And I don't think that's negative in any shape or form.
Thank you, Chair. Can I just add to that? The way you phrased the question, yeah, we should be concerned. We wouldn't be sat here if we weren't concerned. I sat in the Many Down Overview Committee last night, actually, and it was fascinating to have a discussion cross-party on a major project of this council that involved white and pink papers, where there was cross-table cooperation, discussion and engagement, where we talked about processes involving huge sums of money, huge agreements, difficult, complex legal issues, where this council actually, I think, is probably proving itself to be very good. The issue here is that on a project like that, where we do have that cross-party engagement, and members have got different views, and I'm looking across at my colleagues here, and they do have different views on Manydown. But the reality is actually we're working quite cooperatively and quite engaged there. That's a positive point. The very reason we are sat here is because the evidence trail that flows from how this very decision has been taken, and I'm sorry for Councillor Tait because he's picked the baton up and is running with it. In some ways, this is his first statement really tonight of being thrown in at the deep end by his cabinet colleague. The point being here is that this decision does raise questions about how the process was engaged with, about how New River went from one position of having a wholly retail proposal to then through the exclusivity agreement coming back with something as large as the designer outlet centre that it did. How that process happened, because that then leaves this council open to challenge. That then raises the questions of probity, of not just how the process was undertaken, but how decisions were then made. And yes, that's a risk. Of course it's a risk. So yeah, we should be sat here tonight, we should be asking these questions, and we should be holding both the cabinet and officers' feet to the fire in the context of what's being said here. Because I genuinely think, and it felt, when you read the bits, it felt like Manydown all over again. You know that council meeting that we actually sat through, Chair, where we sat there and had to say, and it was Councillor Tilbury and Councillor Bierman at the time, if you do this, you're going to be found to be unlawful. Oh, no, 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 everything's fine, councillors, everything's fine. Just let's listen to each other. On this decision process, if you look at the evidence that, yes, is all in the pink papers, there is genuine cause for concern and reflection. If we do that and do it properly and substantively, then I think we could probably get somewhere with a proper proposal. If we don't, then you run the risk of this council being challenged. We don't want to go there again, do we? So yeah, we should be asking the questions, and it's very right to be sat here this evening. And the question is, it ain't going to end here this evening. Because if you bulldoze on with this and carry on with this, you don't change the parameters of the concerns that are raised. And it raises the question, where do we then go with that?
Thank you. Are there any more questions at all? Oh, I beg your pardon. Yes, Councillor Keating, sorry.
Thank you, Chair. I got the decision now, in principle, that once this is agreed at Cabinet, we're going towards signing a deal. Now, there's an award of a contract. Can I have an idea of timescale of that particular document, please? I don't mean a specific date or time, by the way.
I imagine they will give you that. You need to connect your connection. Questions need to be connected to the risks issue.
The risk is, if we go forward with this without changing anything, the risk is it's superimposed on the decision, because the decision is go ahead with a person or a company that changed the offer after the bidding process. That's the risk. So we're going to have a deal once the cabinet has approved this. Any timescale, please?
Somebody going to respond on that for me? Because I can't. Your microphone, Sean.
Basically, the best thing I can refer you to is the legally privileged advice we had in the original cabinet report, which sets out the pros and cons, it sets out the risks, it sets out the mitigation thereof. And without going into pink, it's kind of all there. We gave members the total picture.
I was just asking for a timescale. You're
talking about. I think yes.
You would do that pretty quickly after making a final decision, and then it kicks off a number of timescales, and that's covered in the legal advice. But as I said to you earlier on, sorting out the actual legal documentation in parallel with that sort of expiry of timescale is months worth of work. These are not quick and easy things.
Okay, thank you. Councillor Golding.
Thank you. Sorry, this is possibly more a question for the legal team. I'm not really sure I'm allowed to do that. But on page 27 of the document we've got, it's white, which is fine. It's a white paper for a change. So the signatories have raised concerns about the risks around the procurement process, but in point 44, there is a statement that says that legal advice was obtained and that things were carried out in accordance with policy and best practice. And I can't find the page in the cabinet report, but I know when I did read it, I felt that actually those risks were quite small. Could somebody please comment? Does that count as a question? Is that a large risk or is that a small risk, I suppose, is the question.
Do you want a moment, Sue? Okay. Are there any more questions? If not, when we move to discussing the call-in. Okay. Councillor Golding, are you okay we move on and we'll pick up that answer later? So, do members wish to have a discussion? Councillor Taylor? Is that, I presume that's a yes.
I would like a discussion, or I'd like to say something, if that's okay.
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
Thank you. I've been waiting a long time for the discussion to begin. As you know, I'm new to scrutiny. I normally sit on regulatory committees, which for me are much more straightforward. If this was a regulatory committee, I would be saying something like, this leisure park is one of the most exciting projects we've had since I became a councillor. I think it's going to inject a whole load of new life into Basingstoke. I don't see it as a threat to Festival Place. I see it as an opportunity to inject new life into Festival Place as well. The people who visit this leisure park will be just minutes away. And if we advertise it correctly, it can be a day out for people. It will be great. However, it isn't a regulatory committee. This is a scrutiny committee. And as I understand it, scrutiny committees are for looking at process. Unless I've been misled, we are here to look at process and to scrutinize whether or not the process has been correct in coming to the point we are today. And so what I've looked at before I came here was, have the risks that are stated in the report been drawn together in a suitable matrix? Yes, they do seem to have done, so that's a key thing. But also, I don't know what detail of discussion we're supposed to go into, whether or not we're supposed to look at all the fine-tuning of the various risks, etc., which is what we seem to be coming into, whether or not we have to listen to people making suggestions of accusations against fellow officers. I can't believe that that's correct either. If we're here just to look at process, if we're here just to look at whether or not this risk assessment is now correct, I note that our legal officer said earlier, she confirmed that the process of drawing the register up is in line with our policy. And therefore, I am satisfied that this risk register is adequate at this stage in the process. I've heard that it's going to be fine-tuned as the proposal becomes more fine-tuned. At this stage, I can't see that we can gain anything by holding up the proceedings any longer.
Thank you. I think I take on board, well, I heard your comments, Councillor Taylor, and my role here is to make sure that we have a proper, open, fair and rational discussion. I don't want anybody going from this room tonight feeling that for some reason the conduct of the meeting was such that they could not feel that way. So apologies if that seems not the way you would have expected it, but that is the reason that it is the way it is.
Thank you, Chair. Yes, no, I'm very happy with that, and I'm happy I've listened to everything, but my mandate is to scrutinise policy, scrutinise process, and I feel that that mandate has been fulfilled.
Carry on then. I'm not going to prolong that. Hannah's point.
Thank you for the time, Chair. Chair, I do appreciate it. It's just a case of finding out what is in the public and what isn't, I'm afraid, that take the time. So I think that the best place to draw you to is actually on page 52, paragraph 15.1. And that confirms the legal position there. And it starts with their opinion was based on outline of what was being proposed by NNR. The council has a strong argument that if it were to complete the current process and accept the revised proposals, that it would still fall within the scope of the original procurement. The other document I would refer to that I'm not willing to discuss is Appendix 13A and Appendix 13B. And also on the risk matrix, this has been dealt with at point 19. But again, I'm not happy to discuss those in open session.
Councillor Golding, are you happy with that, or do you wish to go move into closed session?
No, I'm happy with that, thank you. That was the bit I'd seen and was reassured by.
Okay, good. Does any... Councillor Potter?
I wonder if I could just ask Councillor Taylor. I mean, she did refer to accusations having been made against fellow officers. Did you mean to say officers? I mean, I don't remember any... Oh, that's all right. I thought it was more important than that.
Thank you. Can I take it that the committee doesn't want to have any further discussions, or you do wish to have? Okay, good. All right, then we will go to a discussion time. Are we likely to want to go to a closed session? You don't think so at the moment? Okay. Then discussion it is. Councillor James.
Thank you, Chairman. I have to say, having seen this, the risk matrix, I think it's fundamentally flawed. I think we've got an agreement here that the cabinet decision is to enter into legal agreements, delegated powers to the portfolio holder to enter into development agreements with an outside body without all the risks being properly mitigated. Once you're into an agreement, a legally binding agreement, you cannot then start making stuff up, because if it interferes with the agreement, then the other body has a right to say, no, you can't do that. We entered into agreement in good faith on this basis, which is this basis. The risks have not been properly considered at this stage. It's absolutely essential that we look at all the risks now, consider all the risks now, before we go into agreements or planning. To go ahead in the state we're in, I think will end up, or potentially lead in embarrassment. I think it will lead us with either no leisure park, or a leisure park that doesn't serve the interests of the people of Basingstoke, but serves the interest of a designer outlet centre and the shoppers who want it, regional shoppers, not local shoppers. The leisure park is there for everyone to use and enjoy and affordable to all sections of the community. That doesn't seem to be the vision for the future. The impact on the town centre has been barely touched. I appreciate some things are down to planning, but fundamentals such as the shuttle bus service and its future, before you progress, you need to know where is the alternative shuttle service going to run from. You can't go ahead, because if the cost of losing the shuttle bus is so significant to the town, and it has wider impact than regenerating the leisure park, it should be a showstopper. There's no red lines, there's red squares of risk identified, but there is no red lines that if we can't resolve this, we do not progress. It just seems to be, we'll carry on progressing, we'll trundle along, we'll sign an agreement, and any other problems will pop up at planning. That's too late. This has MAL's 2 written all over it, and possibly written in very bold ink. It could be a lot worse than the MAL's. I think this has been rushed for no reason. I think there's plenty of opportunity to make sure we get the risk right. I have some doubts about whether it's in the best interest of the borough anyway, but if we're going to do it, and the Cabinet have agreed to do it, then we've got to do it absolutely right. This is the future of Basingstoke we're dealing with. We'll be here for 2 years, 4 years, 8 years. This leisure park will be here with its associated retail, ancillary retail, we should call it, for the next 50, 60, 100 years. The impact on the town centre will not last for a political lifetime. It will last for a generation or two. So it's absolutely important we get it right. And I think at the moment, the risk matrix we have in place and the risk assessments being done are absolutely flawed, very, very poor. I'd like to see Basingstoke be the best and get things right. I want people to come from all over Europe to see our leisure park so they can see how a local authority does it right. At the moment, I don't see that happening. I see it more as a documentary that Panorama will cover at some point. So I think we should set back the decision. I'd advise the cabinet member to put the decision back. I appreciate he's only picked it up recently, to review whether he's really happy to put his name to the risk we have, and he's happy to stand there and explain to the people of Basingstoke if this goes badly wrong, and as a consequence, there's a £10 million black hole in the budget, and he's overspent and wasted £10 million of taxpayers' money because he couldn't do a risk assessment, if he's happy to do that. If I was him, I would certainly not proceed on this basis. I would certainly want a lot more detailed risk assessment, a lot more analysis done before I proceeded.
Thank you, Councillor Potter. Councillor Keating.
Thank you, Chair. The first significant point I want to make is I think it is bordering on criminal that we're talking about entering into an agreement of significance to this whole borough, without having consulted the public once, without even telling the public what we're proposing to do. We're not telling them how much we're going to spend. We're not telling them how it's going to be done. We're not telling them that they have a say. If the public, in consultation, says, we do not want any of that, we will already have signed the deal. We will already have signed the deal. So I think that's a fundamental problem with the way this is being progressed. As a ward councillor for the Leisure Park, when I was consulted with my colleagues by the Cabinet and by New River Retail, the first and most important thing we said to everybody was that we supported the regeneration of the Leisure Park. 100%. We supported the regeneration of the Leisure Park. That was the original proposition. And we supported that proposition because it was the right thing to do for Basingstoke. We would have, at that point, have wanted the council to consult the public and get them on board to approve the concept of regenerating the Leisure Park. But now we've moved from regeneration the Leisure Park and looking for partners to regenerating the Leisure Park on condition that we have a designer outlet centre. Because that was what seems to be the proposition. And nobody other than New River has had an opportunity to organise or bid for designing a designer centre. Introducing a designer centre. There's 33 of them in the UK, and New River hasn't done any one of them. But there are loads of expertise out there about designer centres, but nobody's got a shot at it. So that causes me concern. That genuinely causes me concern. I think that that's potentially a showstopper in that someone could well organise a challenge to the borough council saying you've put the thing out for tender on one basis and you've signed a deal on a totally different basis. The other thing I'm concerned about is it's the small things. The people of Basingstoke know and have used the Leisure Park year after year after year. They go to the Leisure Park and they park their vehicles and they use the different facilities. Now, the different facilities have different costs and values, but some of the facilities are overpriced and compared to the poor people of Basingstoke being able to use them. But nonetheless, having free car parking does help enormously. Now, I know that the cabinet member has said, oh, we haven't made any decision about car parking, but I can tell you, I would anticipate that car parking charges will inevitably follow this. It will inevitably follow it. And the other thing I think you need to be concerned about is getting planning permission. Because if the roads aren't sorted out, if the impact on the town centre is not sorted out, And if the access points to and from the retail and leisure park is not sorted out, then planning is going to be a big problem. So I find that of concern. I want the leisure park to be regenerated. I don't see the need for a designer outlet centre. We've managed without one. Lots of towns and cities in the UK continue to have no designer outlets. If the designer outlet has to come, and if it does come, I would wish it well. Because at least then we the borough, would benefit from the income generated. But apart from that, there's nothing wrong with the proposal. Thank you.
Thank you. Councillor Robinson.
Thank you, Chairman. I'd just like to pick up on a point that Councillor Keating made about the process of the scope having changed. I think the legal officer mentioned earlier that, and it's in the white papers actually, that a legal opinion was sought in March from a leading procurement lawyer who advised that it would be, in his view, it would not be the case that the council would be open to legal challenge based on the scope of... But you can only go on the advice that you're given. Legal have got advice from a leading QC who's an expert in his field, and they've advised that that wouldn't be the case. But leaving that out, we've heard a lot about the potential impact on the town, and empty shops in the town centre were mentioned by the signatories. 2 weeks ago, at full council, we agreed a local plan to build 850 homes a year. And in that, we're obviously giving consideration to what people do, what leisure activities they undertake, what shopping they undertake. And I think we need to bear that in mind, that we're not just catering for, if people were saying that we're providing all these shops and we're not providing more people, then there might be an argument, but we are providing that as well. There's also been a lot on ancillary, and you said, why do we need the designer outlet centre? I think what's key from what I've seen is that the funding and the increased funding which results from having a designer outlet centre allows the New River Retail to propose a better leisure park than would otherwise be possible, because they want to provide the best. In Basingstoke, we've said we want it to be a regional destination, and we want to provide the very best leisure facilities that we can. In order to do that, we need to subsidise that somehow, and at the moment we've got a private company who is offering to plough lots of money into the town, create lots of jobs and provide us with a regional destination. But to do that, and it's clear from the split, we're talking about 500,000 square feet / 300,000 square feet, the leisure element is clearly a lot bigger than any proposed retail, ancillary retail use. I'm concerned that tonight, picking up on Councillor Faulkner's point about how this looks to the outside as a potential partner, that if we take this process, and if this process at the end of the evening causes us delay, not on the substance of the decision, because that wasn't the grounds that the call-in was accepted. The call-in was accepted on the fact that the risk assessment wasn't attached, not that it wasn't produced, that it'll do more damage to the council reputationally as a partner, and I'm concerned about that. I think we all want to provide a leisure park for the benefit of our residents, and currently we've got a developer who's interested in doing that, and I'm concerned that if we delay that too much, then we begin to put them off. And it's interesting to note that that risk has been identified, and it does rank quite strongly.
Can I just draw your attention, Councillor Robinson, to paragraph 48 of our colleague's proposed redevelopment of Basingstoke Leisure Park call-in notice. I've no idea. You'll have to find that. I'll read it to you. There we go. Therefore, I consider the call-in is successful on the grounds that the council's risk management policy was not followed, as indicated above. I'm really just... Page 28. I'm merely saying that it wasn't a question of not attaching. It was a question of not in existence at the time. Councillor Tilbury.
Oh, thank you, Chair, yeah. I was on the Leisure Park map, and we looked at this for quite some time, and it was always throughout this, it was all retail would always be ancillary to the Leisure Park. And then suddenly, at the last minute, we suddenly got the new river proposal, which is not really ancillary. It's basically turning it into a designer outlet, which is not what we went out to tender on, as people have said before. And we talk about a gap in the market. It wasn't a gap in the market. If we'd have looked for, if we'd have been looking to create a designer outlet, that's what we would have gone out for. And I suspect there have been quite a few people interested in that, which is suggested in some of the reports there. Now, we talked about some of these other sort of issues there, and the risk of the on the town centre. Well, I mean, actually, we talked Gunwharf Quays comes up in a lot of these reports. I mean, I actually go to Portsmouth quite a lot now. My son's down at Portsmouth University, so I know Gunwharf Quays very well. Really nice development. It's always packed there, but try going into Portsmouth city centre, it's dead. It's actually even deader than Andover. I mean, that's the impact of Gunwharf Quays. It's basically, it's the shopping centre for Portsmouth now. Portsmouth city centre is virtually derelict. It's, you know, there's very little life there. It has a little scrappy old market there, and that's about that. And that's a city. That's not a town like Basingstoke. Portsmouth is a large city with a large catchment area. So Gunwharf Quays has basically wiped that out there. And it's not like they're next door. It's quite a walk from the city centre to Gunwharf Quays. It's quite a trek across there, because the Gunwharf Quays obviously is on the dock side there, which is what makes it attractive. You know, it's a sunny day. It's actually quite pleasant there. You can sit under the Spinnaker Tower and watch the ships going by. Well, you're not going to get that in the Leisure Park, you know, maybe boat in Saunders Field possibly. But coming back to the risk assessment, you know, most of these other projects, they're either in touristy areas or by the seaside or those sort of areas like that. This isn't there, and I think that's clear in the report. So we've got a number of reports, and we, without going into the pink papers, they raise a number of issues and lots of risks. And that's the problem. It's the lack of risk assessment in this. It's sort of, I think they just, you know, don't bother us with the details, show us the money. I think that's the reality with that. They've just looked at that. It reminds me of Gresley Road. When we went through that, I remember sitting in the same room with a call in for Gresley Road, and it was, you know, but yeah, but we're going to get £20 million. Well, it didn't happen, did it? What we've ended up with is probably better for the town. What we've got is a decent thing, a facility that's actually created real jobs and some benefit and works well with the site, whereas what was being proposed there was unbelievable. I mean, it would, you know, thankfully it did fail, because what we've got is far superior. But going back to what I said earlier, if I was a project manager and if I was dealing with this project now and looking at the risks involved in this that have been flagged up to us, I would have very serious concerns. And if I was working for, if this was a company I was working for and it was going down this road, I'd probably be looking for another job now. Thank you.
Councillor Potter.
I mean, I feel we'll fairly predictably split on party lines on this, which I think is sad. I mean, taking Councillor Robinson's point, I mean, had the original brief prepared by Montague Evans talked in terms of a split between 500,000 square feet leisure, 300,000 designer outlet stroke retail, that you would have had, in my humble view, a number of takers, a number of interested parties. But it didn't start that way, and it's been changed over the period on a very exclusive negotiation between a very limited number of people. And quite frankly, I think that's unacceptable, really, in the way that we normally do business. Endorsing what Councillor Tilbury has said, I think the process of measuring risk thus far has been very limited, and I think it should be expanded. If we were seeking tonight to be looking for some interminable delay in this process, I could understand the resistance to that, but nobody is saying that. Certainly I'm not. I'm talking about a reasonable period of delay, a short period under which this can be undertaken to give assurances to a number of people who don't have those assurances at the present time. I remember, I don't want to misquote him, but I was stunned by it at the time, but when I went to Cabinet, I believe the leader actually said at that cabinet meeting I attended, we can undertake this project with no risk to the council. My paraphrasing may be slightly wrong, but that's broadly what he said, and I'm happy to check it on the webcast, which I was stunned by, because clearly we are a public body. There is risk for this public body in entering into this type of contract, and I, for one, want to be absolutely sure that we've measured that risk, and if we eventually go down that road, the forming contracts with New River or the like, then we've measured that risk and know what we're doing. And we quite frankly haven't done that to date. I don't want to say any more. I mean, I think I know the way this is going to go, but it's unfortunate, because I think that there are examples like Councillor Harvey of us working together on a cross-party basis much better than we're doing here. And that's all we're seeking, I think, is that risk assessment to be developed further than it has thus far.
Thank you. Councillor Faulkner.
Taking Councillor Tilbury's point, I don't think Bicester and Swindon are well known as their tourist centres. but when I've announced this project to these six parish councils in our area of North West Hampshire, there's been tremendous excitement. People, you know, threatening to come to Basingstoke regularly, and it's the most exciting thing people have heard in a long, long time. Let's not fall out over that one, shall we? I actually have an inverse fear in terms of risk, that's looking at the draft decision notice. Because, as has been said, this is really still quite early days. And it's not almost like a project, it's a sort of programme of tasks and activities. But when you look at the decision that the Cabinet is making, what worries me actually is it could fall down on several of these, because it's all very well to say agree to enter into heads of terms, agree to enter into a development agreement. But when many of us have probably sat down doing contracts, etc., and you get showstoppers jumping up all over the place. So there's an awful long way to go before this situation is anywhere near the light of day. So I personally feel, with what's been said and done on the risk analysis, comfortable at that stage. And I think it's worth moving to this next stage. And yes, we should be then maybe scrutinising what happens at these stages so that wheels aren't falling off, or we are making commitments we'd rather not get involved in, etc. But I think overall, the idea of the new leisure centre and a retail outlet is one of the best things that we've announced for a very long time, certainly in my 2 years. Well, that's not true, because I read an article in the Basingstoke Observer, which was ecstatic. A whole page and a picture of our leader. Serious stuff. Thank you.
Have you been to Parc Asterix in France, Councillor Faulkner? Are there any more contributions? I will call that a discussion. If not, Councillor James.
I've lived in Basingstoke all my life, and I think I've seen the leisure park regenerated three times, well, certainly twice already. This will be the third regeneration of the leisure park. And I appreciate times have changed. In the old days, it was regenerated through 106 contributions and the council's capital receipts. Obviously, this administration have not budgeted quite so well and now totally dependent on private sector money, because we don't make any contribution to capital receipts and we've missed lots of 106 monies, etc. So there we are. I mean, that's just one of those things. The Cabinet isn't as strong as it used to be and can no longer do these things on its own. What concerns me is, on this occasion, we're going to turn to the private sector. We're going to give them a third of our leisure park to build a shopping centre to fund the regeneration of the leisure facilities. 15, 20 years down the line, still within my lifetime, I hope, we will need to regenerate the leisure park again. And we've already done the bit where we sell place. I just want to understand, because I couldn't see it in the papers and it's not in the risk thing, what, you know, thinking 30 years ahead, which I know obviously the general deal of risk on the basis of what's going to happen tomorrow. But 30 years ahead, what's the plan for the next generation to regenerate the leisure park again? Is that built into the capital receipt we get for this, or the revenue income's going to be ring fenced for that? What is the long-term plan?
Councillor Tate, would you like to respond? Am I not here anymore? Have I gone home? Sorry.
No, that's fine. I was just listening to my colleague. It's worth remembering that we remain the freeholder. So we have a constant overview of what's going on, and we can also be part of the future redevelopment of that by being the freeholder. I think it's impossible to say what nature that development will take and when it will take place, because frankly, it is a long way away, clearly, We have a partner that is in this for the long haul, have proven to be doing things, developing things in the long haul. So it's impossible to say, but as the freeholder, we remain overseeing the site.
Can I just confirm that we're the freeholder, but there's a lease of how many years? 250? Yeah, that's dead easy.
250 years, same as Festival Place.
Okay, thank you.
So in terms of raising the funds for regeneration in the future, we've not really given that a thought. That's the next generation's problem. We've got no long-term planning involved, because presumably all we can do is sell another third of it to retail at that point. I don't know.
It's much the same as Festival Place. I mean, ultimately, you know, that will get to a stage where we'll need major redevelopment works. It might be 50 years, might be 100 years, who knows what. It'll be the head tenant there that is their problem, but they will have to come to Basingstoke and Dean as landlord slope freeholder to actually get the agreement to what they want to do there. Hard to envisage what it'll be, you know, Festival Place 100 years. Don't know is the honest answer, but it'll be up to, you know, the current owners or their, you know, subsequent owners after that to deal with it.
It's within the interest of owners of places like Festival Place to regenerate it into retail, because we know that retail is, you know, it's financially viable standalone as retail because it raises good money. Leisure, we know there is no money in leisure. It doesn't raise money. We've looked at various options for the leisure park, and we always knew that a partner would have to have something else to make it pay. There's no money in it. So how are you going to raise money in 30 years' time to regenerate? I mean, if you don't have to, but you could see New River saying, well, we're not going to pump a load of money into this unless you allow us a bit more retail, and we need to change the heads of terms. We seem to have no plan in place. That's what concerns me.
Okay. Do you want to respond again?
I can do. I mean, basically, the answer will be we will cover that off the lease to make sure that we have the power to do, you know, what is reasonable in the circumstances. And it, you know, it's the same what we've done with Festival Place. You don't give away all your controls, but conversely, you can't speculate what 50 years is going to bring to the table.
Yeah, but, might I just suggest that, you know, terminating a lease of that nature would not be a simple job. No. So it is. Might also suggest then that it is a further risk. I think I've made my point. Members.
Just in relation to the lease situation and redevelopments in the future, if you have 999 year leases, then as Mike has said, as the freeholder, as the landlord, you have total control over any development or redevelopment of the site. And generally speaking, if a redevelopment proposal comes forward in 50 years, then they will come to you for a restructuring and a regearing of the lease. So therefore, that's the control you have. They'll want, that is the tenants, would want to redevelop because that would make more money for them and increase their investment. So therefore, what you would be as landlords, you would be looking at maximizing their investment and maximizing your return on it. So there is still adequate control. I've been involved in several of these in my previous life, and that's how it's always been done.
Thank you. I'm loath to, for goodness sake. Councillor Smith.
Thank you for that warm welcome, Chairman.
Councillor Smith, I miss your warmth.
No,
from
I can only imagine.
Seat. I know.
Yeah. Just a few minor points, and I'll be brief because I understand where your side was coming from. Firstly, the word ancillary, I get concerned sometimes is not fully understood. So I've had a little Google, and it comes up and tells me that providing necessary support to the primary activities, which I think is actually spot on for what this is. So the primary activities are leisure. There's a ratio of 6 to 3 or 5 to 3 on that. And this is ancillary and 2 to 1 leisure. Absolutely, great. So that what that shows is that this supports the leisure, allows the leisure to happen, is ancillary. I really do understand the risks that members have raised, that signatories have raised, and the concerns. And of course, with a project like this, everyone will have concerns. There will be things that need sorting. I think we all understand that. That's why there's a risk register. That's why there are risks report in the report, although I agree having them in a matrix is better. And I think, you know, most people are espoused in agreement that actually they are a snapshot and there are more things, there are more risks. And yes, more needs to be done to look at mitigating those. I don't think there's any disagreement about that. I have call it naive faith as well, but faith in Councillor Tait to do some work on mitigating those. And I think it's disingenuous to suggest that when he says that'll have to be sorted before planning, that means he's going to get to a planning meeting, or that whoever brings this forward is going to get to a planning meeting and go, oh, I haven't thought about where to put the park and ride yet. Because they will obviously before getting to that point. It was interesting to hear Councillor James say that there's no money in leisure. We know that. That's why we're where we are. And actually, I think, and it feels a bit, forgive me, I'll be very brief, it feels a bit like the EU debate where sometimes it's all, oh, here's a negative of why we can't leave. Actually, there's a really positive story for the retail. There's a really positive story for offering something different in our town, for making it a regional destination, for offering something bigger and better than there is anywhere else in the country at the moment. And I understand that will create concerns for the town centre. I understand that will have an impact on Festival Place. But actually, I agree with Councillor Taylor that that can be a benefit to everyone. And bringing more people here with increased residential numbers, increased residents of the town, can only be good. And having an alternative offer is brilliant. Because I know if I go to Bicester, which is probably the most realistic alternative we have in this country at the moment, I'm going to walk around every shop. I might buy a tie, but I'm going to feel guilty about spending 30 quid on a tie. And then I'm going to go back to where I normally shop, probably Marks and Spencer's, and buy my suit there. And actually, I think that's what this will be. There will be some people that will go and buy one Mulberry handbag once a year. Not me, unfortunately, but will go and buy their one Mulberry handbag once a year. But their day-to-day shopping is still going to be done in other places. So it's a different offer. I understand it creates challenges, but those are ones that I have great faith in the town centre and Festival Place and us as a borough to work through and correct and to fix and to make better. I would just say, because Winklebury, obviously, is my ward and is neighbouring to it, has mentioned a couple of times, I have spoken to different residents about this. I have so far had complete and utter unanimity that it is a wholly positive thing. Have so far had unanimity that it is a completely positive thing.
Thank you, Councillor Smith. Oh, Councillor Miller.
Now I'll say, Chairman, please let the vote be put.
Well, I'm not going to do that because I do really need to allow. I have to ask the signatories if they're satisfied and the cabinet member to make final comments. And I would have thought that we would all want that to happen. Okay. So, can I ask the signatories? Are you? Am I going to sum up? Yes, I could do. Well, my brief summary will be that there has been considerable debate about the risk register, its existence, how it was compiled, when it was compiled, and whether it actually was already in existence, because clearly the monitoring officer found that it wasn't. I believe there are some unanswered questions from today's debate. The issue of public consultation has been raised, and I don't think that's been lost on, I hope it hasn't been lost on the cabinet member. There's disagreement on whether this could be referred back to the cabinet, but then I expected that. There are serious traffic and parking concerns, and I don't think there's any disagreement about that. I think there is disagreement still over what is to be approved or not approved. There is some confidence in the risks from some people on the committee. There is a view also that Basingstoke will be a successful, flourishing town as a result of this. And at the same time, there's been some considerable doubt expressed. So those are briefly what I would say are the main points of discussion, and that would form my summing up. So can I now just ask the signatories if you're satisfied with the progress of tonight and whether or not you want to make some brief closing comments.
Thank you, Chairman. I'd like to thank the committee for there's been some good debate and lots of really useful comments made. I'm disappointed more than anything else, because I think party politics aside, and there's definitely been a split here tonight. I've been on statutory committees, as Councillor Taylor has, and this is a regular sized document for DC. But I think some members have missed the opportunity to look through the pink in here. You talk about members of residents in Winklebury, you've spoken to them, if they were to see some of the things in here. We have not talked about the pink. We've avoided the pink. And I would have hoped that some members in here would have spent more time looking at the pink. It's a large amount of this document, which speaks for itself, really. And I just think that I would have hoped that the committee would have at least said, well, you know, this is not, this calling's not frivolous, you know, it's not, it hasn't, it's not improper. We brought it here for good reasons, and we'd hope the committee would have at least given it 7 days to have a look at it and maybe help to improve the cabinet's future decision. And that's really all I can say. Thank you.
You know, walking around Festival Place when it was being built 10 years ago and seeing the enthusiasm about an amazing town centre that was being transformed and regenerated, we have got success. This isn't year zero, as if this administration is suddenly creating a brand new Basingstoke, a Garden of Eden, on the back of their decisions. We have got success in this town. And we have got good businesses, and we've got good shopping centres, and we've got good retail, and we've got good leisure. We have that already. Yeah, we want to make it better. So we're agreed round the table, aren't we? We want the very best leisure park we can possibly have for our residents. Tick in the box. How you get there is the question. And this criticism can't be of Councillor Tait, because he has only just picked up the brief on this. It has to be of where we've got to thus far. And just let's just revisit this, Chair, if you will forgive me. The driver is the opportunity to redevelop the leisure park. That was what was said. Yes, it is. The issue is the marketplace. Well, we tendered in the marketplace to redevelop the leisure park. And those people who came forward and said, I quite think we might be able to do retail here, were put off from making bids. New River Retail were the only show in town, because they presented us a fully leisure proposal. And it took until the exclusivity contract for that to change, and then in December 2015, for it to come back with the retail element attached. Now, I don't know what your procurement process is, but that would have said to me, pause, stop, think again, where are we in this? And the legal advice on the pink papers does contradict that which is in the white. You can talk about the white because it's easy, because you can. And the public have a right to know that in the pink papers, it says something different. That's a really important point. There is a matter of opinion as to the extent in both. That's all I need to say. I don't need to go any further, because to do so would take us into closed session. Is the desire to have a designer outlet centre, or is the desire to have a brand new leisure park? New River came across, as I said, with a wholly leisure proposal. I sat there with Councillor James and Councillor Tilbury in the proposal, and they came in there with a really exciting, amazing leisure park proposal. If it didn't stack up then, what in the world were they doing sat in the room with us during that presentation? If a wholly leisure park proposal did not stack up to them with all the paperwork that was attached to it, which we got in pink papers, then what in the world were they doing sat in that room with us there, and why were they allowed to get that far? Well, they were. And they were processed on the proposal they presented, and then they chose to change the goalposts. We still haven't had an answer over who changed the goalposts. The key here, I think, is the decision and its impact on our town centre, jobs and businesses. Does this make economic sense for Basingstoke? We've got Waitrose, we've got John Lewis, brilliant. We've got Festival Place that needs to see investment. We've got the top of town that needs to see investment. If we are going to invest in our town, let us invest in the places we have got that we want to see continue to be successful first. And if these bright ideas for a designer outlet centre come along, make sure they don't damage the town centre. And if there's any message that we're sending out, not to New River Retail, but to the investors in the town centre, or the shop owners, or those who have got jobs in the town centre, that actually we value New River's designer outlet centre more than we value your job, your business and our town centre, then that's a foolish place to put ourselves in. We shouldn't be there in that respect. We should not be there with this decision. It's a silly place to put ourselves. You said quite clearly, and it was said this evening, fully expect it to have missing elements of risk analysis. We don't know what the risks are. That's been said this evening. The red and the amber that's been alluded to, where the risks are clearly identified. Does that justify the Cabinet moving to a heads of terms and a delivery agreement that the officer quite clearly says will be not able for us to get out of? If you make this decision, if Cabinet press the button on this, there will be a reasonable expectation of progression from New River Retail. That's the point. Legally, we will be putting ourselves in that position of no return, despite all the concerns and the issues. We had the Tesco's application on the Smiths Industry site a few years ago, and the appeal inspector said there was no more retail capacity in our town. We looked at the football club. The football club was looking at retail. There was no more retail. Was there retail capacity in our town? Because the point was, would it damage the town centre? The reason we're looking on Basing View, and it's worth just mentioning Basing View quickly, is the point we're trying to get out of those ground leases that are 199 years and 150 year leases on Basing View, because the investors there don't want to invest in their sites, and we're left picking up the pieces by having to buy them out. There's swings and roundabouts in all of this. All I would say, Chair, in concluding and just trying to say to members, look, this doesn't have cross-party support. This situation we find ourselves in does not have cross-party support. That's quite clear. New River Retail might have the proposal. That's not the point. We want a new leisure park that could be the very best for our residents and for our aspirations and their aspirations. How you get there, we can discuss and work with. But at the moment, with the proposal you've put on the table with New River Retail, with the way that this has been gone about, and I know that's not your fault, Councillor Tate, that's other people's responsibility, but the way that this has been gone about, it does raise questions. And if the public could see what was in the pink papers, they would share our concerns. I am absolutely confident of that because of what we see here as members. So, Chair, I would invite the Cabinet to think again, and I would invite them to hold the decision, and I would invite them to engage properly across party in how this whole regeneration of the leisure park can be positively taken forward.
Thank you, Councillor Tate. Well, if you're going to talk about pink, we've got to throw everybody
in. No, it'll be quick. It's purely just to draw members' attention to, in terms of the legal advice, it is on pink papers. I'm not willing to discuss it in this forum, but the relevant paragraph is paragraph 60 on page 285, the concluding statements of Councillor's opinion. Don't propose to go into that any further, but I do want that to be brought to members' attention. Apologies, I'm not going to enter into discussion on it. It's paragraph 60 on page 285. Sorry, I should have clarified. I'm not going to enter into discussion in public session.
But that has to be read in context with the rest of the paper, Mel. You've picked out that paragraph, but read the rest as well. To be fair, to be absolutely fair in this debate.
The only statement I make is we are in public session. I feel I've said all I can say in public session, and I'm not willing to make any further comment on that particular point.
I have to ask the committee if they want to go into private session.
Can I just be entirely clear, you know, in terms of Melanie's comment there? I mean, is she saying that what Councillor Harvey said is misleading in the context of this paragraph, that we're not referring to verbatim? I mean, what is she saying there? Because I read that differently.
I can't get into the minutiae detail on legal advice in a public session. All I'm aiming, that is fair, this is legally professionally privileged document for an appropriate reason. All I am doing is drawing members' attention to the concluding paragraph of the advice that was received. Others may have different views on that advice, but I'm not going to go into those views. I'm telling you what the position is.
Without quoting it, can I just ask Mary, if she looks at the last four words of paragraph 60, I mean, is that ambiguous?
I don't feel it necessary to enter into the discussion. I've just drawn, all I have done is drawn members' attention to paragraph 60, which is the concluding paragraph of Councillor's advice. I don't feel in public session it's appropriate for me to go in further. Councillor Harvey seems satisfied with my response on that particular point, and I'm not willing to comment in public session any further.
Well, Councillor Harvey, maybe I'm not, but I'm telling you that is not ambiguous, and it's written in a very clear, as I say, unambiguous way as to what would the outcome be. And I think, you know, quite frankly, we can all read that. It doesn't say may, doesn't say anything else, it says would.
Councillor Smith.
I mean, this is
I mean, it's impossible to talk about, frankly, in open session, but there are other words before that sentence which completely change the use of those four words. So to pick out four words is ridiculous.
Okay. Clearly, if you want to go into a debate in private session, we can do so.
I think the point to note is that there's disagreement about the interpretation of the advice received by Council, and I think that is noted, that that's been raised by Councillor Potter, that's been raised by Councillor Harvey. Unless you want to go into private session, I don't think there's anything more we can say.
Councillor Potter?
No, I mean, as Councillor Gavin James points out to me, I won't get a better answer from a lawyer than that, so I won't pursue it, and I don't want to delay proceedings. Well, that was a sort of compliment, as you realise, yeah.
Chair, the only thing I would add to Mel is I am uncomfortable with the amount of paperwork that is on Pink in the first place, such that members of the public cannot see these arguments, and I would love to see it published. The Manydown legal documentation was publicly published. We had to challenge it all the way to get it, but it was, and the result of that was a much better and informed debate as a process. So I'm very disappointed that this is on Pink in the first place.
Okay, thank you. I'm going to invite the Cabinet Member to make some final comments, and then we will take the decision.
Thank you, Chair. Thanks to the committee for the dialogue, actually, which is instructive and useful. And the issue itself is very clear from many people's point of view of what is the difficulties that many councillors feel about the project as it stands, as it becomes something that is a more defined rather than a concept. And there have been a number, even within the sort of closing comments, a number of issues brought up, and without at risk of sort of going through them again, I see overall that they do fit within the risk matrix. You know, I can see referring to them, for example, the shuttle bus, it's there. The shuttle bus with mitigation is there. So I understand, and I don't want to go through the whole thing, we just revisit the same arguments, but I do think that it's worth looking at some of these, and I'm quite happy to go through the list that I've picked out of this from here and refresh myself to ensure that in fact they are there. Largely, I think the issue of risk is well covered and well understood within the Cabinet decision. I also understand that there is a huge degree of concern as to how this becomes something that really benefits the whole of Basingstoke. You know, whether that's the town centre, whether that's different wards in terms of how they perceive what it will bring, I absolutely get that. You know, the importance that all of us are trying to do here is put together a proposal that meets the aspirations of the people that live here, that is the most effective use of the finance that's available within the marketplace or within the council to do this, and to provide something that everybody's going to be proud of and want to sign up with. Now, I understand currently we're not in that position. I look at the decision and I feel, you know, clearly I'm going to say that I feel that the issues that we've discussed and are developed within discussion positively, but I still understand that whether it's consultation, whether it's traffic, whether it's planning, you know, all this as we move on will become of major importance. Consultation will be extremely important. It's not quite true to say there's been no consultation. There has been a media presence of this in outline, but that's not a consultation. That's just a media outline which says we're going to do something. Isn't this wonderful? So there is a lot to go with this currently, but going back to where we are with this decision at this particular point in time, whilst I've learnt a lot from this about where we're going with it, I think that, and clearly the committee will have a view and decide what it wants to recommend. And you know, clearly I will take that on board. But in also the more general point in taking on board the comments that all the councillors have made about how we generate this in the future, how we deal with this. Yeah, I think there's been a lot of learning from that, which I can take on, which I hope we can deliver in a more positive way as we go through the next stage of this. That's it.
Thank you very much indeed, and thank you, members, for what's been an extremely interesting evening. There are two decisions that you can take. One is to take no further action, and the other is to refer the decision back. So I'll put them both to you so there can be no doubt at all. Can I see those who would like to take no further action, please? Okay, those against taking no further action? It's not going to take long, is it? Those in favour of referring the decision back? Those against referring the decision back? Thank you. So there will be no further action and the decision takes effect. Thank you for your patience, members. Meeting's now closed.